Well, welcome, everyone, this beautiful September 12th morning. Bienvenue à tous à notre réunion publique ce matin. Quay. It's been 3 months since I've had the pleasure of being in the role of chair. Et depuis ces trois mois, c'était trois mois pas mal excitants et pas mal remplis, beaucoup d'activités qui sont passées. In the last 3 months, I've had the luxury of having numerous briefings with Mark and his executive team, and have had the opportunity to really have a much greater understanding of the NCC and the impact it has in this community. Numerous activities over the last 3 months, including, as I mentioned, briefings across all of the branches of the organization, meetings with all the branch staffs that we had last week, which was a great opportunity to hear from the staff directly around numerous of the great things happening here at the NCC. Des réunions avec nos députés locaux, avec les maires de les deux municipalités de la région, la maire Watson et la maire Patneau-Jobin, plusieurs conseillers municipaux, briefings with and meetings with the chiefs from both the Algonquin nations, Kitiganzibi and Pikwaknagon, Chief White Duck and White Duck respectively, and meetings with numerous of our private sector partners that are involved with the NCC, numerous stakeholders, events over the last 3 months, including the Canada Day events and the numerous Canada 150 events taking place on NCC properties or assets, including some of the pavilions, Moisic Canada, dans la région de Gatineau, as well as site visits that I've been very privileged to visit across Gatineau Park, dans la région d'Ottawa. It's really provided me an opportunity to have a much deeper understanding of the impact that the NCC has in this wonderful National Capital Region. So first of all, I want to thank Mark and the team across the NCC for spending so much time over the last 3 months to really brief me and to provide these wonderful opportunities to participate in these events and site visits. J'aimerais remercier mes collègues du conseil d'administration que j'ai eu la chance chacun d'avoir une entrevue, une discussion un à un sur au cours de l'été pour comprendre aussi leur perspective concernant l'administration et la gouvernance de la CCN. Those were very helpful discussions, so thank you, colleagues from the board, for giving me the time this summer to spend a little bit of time with yourselves to better understand each of the respective issues and to make sure that we continue as we evolve and grow the NCC to have that national significance. A lot of my colleagues from the board are from different parts across the country, and it's very interesting to understand and see the impact that the NCC is having, not just on the National Capital Region, but for Canadians alike. So thank you very much for those wonderful opportunities to engage. Yesterday I had my first annual public meeting, and I thought it was a wonderful opportunity to engage with our local citizens, and it continues in the vein of transparency and engagement that the NCC has really built a strong foundation. And today I'd like to thank members of the media and members of the public to be here. We're very fortunate as an organization to have the engaged public, engaged media. I know numerous organizations in the National Capital Region would love to have that level of engagement and opportunity to meet with our members of the media and members of the public. And so we're very fortunate and very grateful that you take your time out of your busy schedules to participate, whether it's at the annual public meeting or at our ongoing board meeting. So thank you very much for being present and being active participants in the discussions with the NCC. Cette semaine, on va avoir notre retraite stratégique pour le Conseil. dans les prochains jours. C'est une opportunité de continuer à discuter les enjeux qui sont très importants et les priorités de la CCN et de comment on peut continuer à s'améliorer pour être une organisation qui est très collaborative et engagée avec nos citoyens. We'll be able to, through the course of our vision, to continue to discuss some of our key priorities, including our priority that's listed in the NCC's plan on being one of high-performing organizational excellence. It's been a mission for the NCC the last number of years, and it's our goal and our responsibility as directors and as a board to continue to evolve that vision of organizational excellence and to continue to work on being as collaborative as possible with our community, our stakeholders, our partners, our municipalities, and having a very collaborative relationship across all of those important stakeholders that we have. The other aspect that we've talked about and I've referenced just in my last few remarks is the significance of the role that the NCC plays in this community with the numerous assets and the numerous properties that it has, the Greenbelt, the Gatineau Park, our parkways, our pathways, the Rideau Canal, the numerous, the 1,600 or so properties and assets. These are aspects that we as a board need to continue to foster and have pride and inspiration for our community. These are assets that have a major impact in the day-to-day lives of our citizens on both sides of the river, in Gatineau and Ottawa. And there are assets that are of pride and significance for all Canadians when you think of our monuments and our numerous Confederation Boulevard impacts. So that's, you know, we need to continue to what we heard very loudly yesterday at our annual public meeting, that we need to communicate more and we need to be more engaged in terms of storytelling all of these wonderful assets and impacts that we have in this community, and that'll be part of our strategic retreat as well, so that we can discuss how we can continue to evolve the mission of the National Capital Commission and the impact and the storytelling and the significance that it has in this region. And lastly, I think as we go through our retreat as board members and as an organization, continuing to look at how we can be an organization focused on outcomes and results, that our projects are layered in strong consultative process, strong engagement, significant planning and thought. I thought, you know, the comments yesterday around being sober thought was a really good perspective, but that our focused approach on process and on engagement and consulting and on planning is with a vision towards outcomes and towards some significant results. And I think that that's a really good opportunity for the board to continue to reflect and discuss how we can, as we have this mission of high-performing organization and organizational excellence, that we really have a really strong understanding and a strong perspective on how we want our process to be leading us to a strong vision and strong outcomes. Alors, c'est un gros plaisir d'être ici encore pour gérer cette réunion. Il y a bon point qu'on va discuter aujourd'hui, mais c'est comme j'ai dit plusieurs fois, je vous remercie mes collègues, les membres du public, les membres du média, les membres de l'équipe organisationnelle de la CCN pour les derniers mois, et je suis certain qu'on va avoir une bonne journée productive aujourd'hui et une bonne retraite stratégique les prochains jours où est-ce qu'on pourra continuer à évoluer notre vision et notre engagement dans cette communauté. Alors, ce point-ci, je tourne la parole à Marc Christmanson.
Bon, on va adopter la...
Thank you. Yes, thank you. I need a motion to adopt our minutes. Thank you. The agenda for today's meeting, sorry, thank you. We have both Lisa and Carol has seconding. All in favor? Thank you. And then declaration of any conflicts of interest. Thank you. And the adoption of the minutes from the previous meeting. Okay, seconded by Victor. All in favor? Okay, passed. Thank you very much. And now the report on activities, Dr. Christensen.
Just you might want to check if there's any business arising from the minutes. I don't think there is, but...
Was there any business arising from the previous meeting, minutes from the previous meeting? I know if we passed it, but no. Okay, great. Okay, good. Thank you.
Okay, good. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Welcome again to chairing our meetings. We appreciate your comments. It's been a great summer onboarding you, and I'm glad you've enjoyed it. I'd like to welcome everyone here to the public meeting of the NCC's Board of Directors. Bienvenue, and also all the people who are watching on YouTube. We usually have a fairly good audience now watching online, so welcome to you as well. Welcome to members of the media, Mr. Hayden, Mr. Westindy, others who are joining us today. Before I begin, I'd like to express on behalf of the whole board and our staff the NCC's support for Peter Reuter and his family, a Black Rapids farm in the Greenbelt. You may have seen in the media that the Reuters lost 80 cows and a heritage barn in a fire on Friday. Thankfully, nobody was injured, but very unfortunately, the animals were lost. Peter and his family are the latest generation of Reuters to farm this NCC property. It's one of 90 farms the NCC owns in the Greenbelt, and this is a relationship that goes back decades. In fact, the Reuters are valued contributors to sustainable agriculture in the capital, and we will be doing what we can to help Peter and his family recover from this setback. It has been another extremely busy summer for the Capital and for the NCC, and since our last meeting in June, the Canada 150 celebrations have continued. I think they've been successful beyond everyone's expectations. Je tiens donc à féliciter Mère Watson et aussi Mère Pednaud-Jobin. Elle n'est pas ici aujourd'hui, mais pour les initiatives Ottawa 2017 et Gatineau 2017. Aussi, les activités de nos collègues de patrimoine canadien ont aussi été couronnées de succès. Merci à tous ceux et celles qui ont contribué de façon si exceptionnelle à la tenue des célébrations dans la capitale. The NCC's own initiatives have inspired fond memories of the sesquicentennial for residents of the capital and for many, many visitors. And I think they will leave legacies that will benefit the capital and Canadians for many years to come. We've also been pleased to support events produced by our partners, such as La Machine, the Canada Day celebrations, and also through our design approvals team, projects such as the renewal of the National Arts Centre and the Canada Museum of Science and Technology. The NCC and its assets play a vital role in the remarkable quality of life enjoyed by residents of the capital and in the wonderful impression it leaves on the people who visit here. Now, every 10 years, the NCC, like other Crown agencies, undergoes a special examination by the Auditor General of Canada. La dernière examen remontait à 2007, et au cours de l'année écoulée, nous avons travaillé étroitement avec le Bureau de vérificateur général à la préparation du rapport de cette année. I'm very pleased to say that the Auditor General's report is positive on almost every count. I think out of 24, 22 came up very, very positive. The 23rd was asking us to look more closely at our risk management practices, which we will do. And the 24th, I'll talk a bit about in a minute about deferred maintenance. But on the whole, it affirmed the good management of the NCC, the quality of its staff and services in fulfilling its national mandate. The issue that it raised for the NCC is the problem of deferred maintenance of its infrastructure, and it's a problem that we share with many municipalities and other agencies owning assets and land assets. And we're actually pleased that the Auditor General brought this up in a timely fashion. We'll be addressing this issue through the appropriate channels in the coming months. It provides us with an opportunity to remind residents and also visitors of the scope of the NCC's portfolio as the single largest landowner in the capital. To give some idea of the scale of this responsibility, there are more than 500 square kilometres within the National Capital Region under the NCC stewardship, including 300 kilometres of pathways, 125 kilometres of parkways, two of the interprovincial bridges, and more than 100 other bridges, le Parc de la Gatineau, le Centre de Verdure et 13 autres parcs urbains, les 6 résidences officielles et de nombreux édifices patrimoniaux, almost 200 commemorative sites, interpretive panels, and works of public art. Overall, 1,700 properties with more than 1,000 buildings, and more than 3,000 other elements of infrastructure, including retaining walls, culverts, electrical and mechanical systems, and the list goes on. The replacement of these assets, not including land, is at least $1.7 billion. And I really do want to commend the staff of the NCC for the excellent work they've done to maintain this huge asset base at a very high quality with an annual capital appropriation of $22.7 million. Le vérificateur général a tout de même établi que le rapport de l'entretien différé constitue un risque pour la CCN et je tiens à rassurer les membres du Conseil et ceux et celles qui nous écoutent que notre approche basée sur le risque pour notre budget d'immobilisation assure que la santé et la sécurité des résidents de la capitale et de ses visiteurs passent avant tout. Les membres du Conseil savent que nous travaillons à ce dossier depuis un certain temps et nous avons respecté notre engagement envers le vérificateur général de présenter avant le 30 juin des rapports sur l'état de nos actifs. Ils ont été confiés à un tiers pour un examen indépendant. This forms part of our discussions with the central agencies, and we'll be coming back to the board with a full report on deferred maintenance at an upcoming meeting. I would also echo the statements of our chair regarding last night's annual public meeting held in the Capital Urbanism Lab. Thank you to all who attended and everyone from the board who was there. Cette fois encore, nous profitons de l'Assemblée publique annuelle pour lancer le processus de planification stratégique pour l'année qui vient. Des idées judicieuses ont été formulées aux membres du Conseil, ce qui éclairera nos discussions stratégiques au cours des prochains jours. It's been a very full summer since the last meeting. I have more to cover, so I'll proceed with my report according to the NCC's six corporate priorities. The first is to facilitate and support Le Breton Flats and the islands in becoming a signature destination of national significance. On the redevelopment of Le Breton Flats, the NCC continues its negotiations with the Rendezvous Le Breton Group. Last week, our chair and I had a very productive meeting with Eugene Melnick, John Ruddy, and Tom Anselmi from Rendezvous Le Breton. Yesterday, we also had a very good meeting with the City of Ottawa, which will have a crucial role to play in realizing a revitalized urban community at Le Breton Flats. In these meetings, we agreed that maintaining effective collaborative partnerships between the developer, ourselves, and with the city are a key to the project's success. The NCC's negotiations with the Rendezvous Le Breton Group will continue in the coming months, and we expressed our desire to advance the work required substantially in order to reach an agreement in principle by the end of the year. Our second priority is to offer public access and new connections for Canadians to discover the shorelines and waterways. The repairs that followed this year's spring floods are continuing. In particular, the board members will be pleased to know that the work on the section of Ottawa River pathway from the Parliament Hill staircase to the Portage Bridge began on August 14th and will reopen as soon as possible. I'd like to thank our design and construction staff for writing specifications, tendering, and beginning this work in such short order after the floods. Pour ce qui est du sentier des voyageurs entre le pont Portage et le Musée canadien de l'histoire, le CCN travaille à une solution temporaire pour le garder ouvert durant les réparations. Il s'agit de réparations au système d'éclairage de la joue de clôture pour bloquer l'accès des sections érodées de la berge et de l'installation des panneaux de signalisation pour indiquer les parcours qui ne présentent pas de danger. The full rehabilitation of this section of the Voyageur pathway will take place next summer. Concernant le plan d'aménagement des berges nord de la rivière des Outaouais, une consultation publique s'est tenue en juillet. Nous avons également reçu de judicieux commentaires de la ville de Gatineau et un rapport sera présenté en novembre. Je profite aussi de l'occasion pour remercier nos partenaires qui ont bien voulu devenir membres d'un nouveau comité consultatif sur les berges nord de la rivière des Outaouais qui se réunira au cours de la première semaine d'octobre. Un vaste éventail de parties intéressées nous offre son concours dans la ville de Gatineau, le ministère du patrimoine canadien, Service public et approvisionnement Canada, Windmill Development Kruger, le musée canadien de l'histoire, Tourisme Outaouais, le conseil régional de l'environnement et du développement durable de l'Outaouais, Sentinelle de la rivière des Outaouais, la collectivité autochtone et le Vision Centre et la Marina de Hull. On August 15th, I was delighted to participate in the inauguration of the new pedestrian bridge over Leamy Creek. You can see it here. It's built of Corten steel, which is a low-maintenance, highly resilient material. We invited youth from the Kitiganzibi First Nation community to provide the name of the bridge, and they chose Mawandoseg, which means the land where we once gathered for celebration. And we had a wonderful inaugural ceremony. Our third priority is to modernize the NCC's planning framework and renew the long-term plan for Gatineau Park. Next week, we will be begin sharing the plan for Canada's capital with Canadians across the country. Comme je le soulignais lors de notre dernière réunion, ce que nous appelons le plan de la capitale des gens pour l'avenir de la capitale repose sur les idées et l'astuce de citoyens et citoyennes d'une nation à l'autre qui ont participé à son élaboration. The NCC will host events in four provincial capitals to discuss this blueprint for the capital that resulted from the contributions of all of these Canadians. We'll be starting in Charlottetown, the starting point for Confederation, and thank you to Basil for your work organizing our visit to Charlottetown. I'll also remind people there's still time left to visit the exhibition related to the plan for Canada's capital at the Geography and Exploration Pavilion, one of our Confederation Pavilions at 50 Sussex Drive. If you've not seen it yet, it's worth a visit. I'd also like to thank the Royal Canadian Geographical Society for their partnership in presenting the exhibition and also for partnering with us to host these events across the country. Later, we will also hear a submission on an important emerging priority for the NCC, the renewal of the Gatineau Park Master Plan. Le plan sera renouvelé à la suite de larges consultations qui débuteront dans environ un mois. C'est une occasion de faire valoir votre point de vue qui ne se présente qu'une fois par décennie. We really are looking forward to having a profound conversation about the future of Gatineau Park and its sustainability in the face of many pressures of urbanization, climate change, invasive species, and so forth. I encourage everybody to get involved in this important discussion. Our fourth priority is to create lasting legacies to serve as sources of pride for Canadians, including the official residences of Canada. Currently, Rideau Hall is being prepared for the arrival of the Governor General Designate, Julie Payette, and we look forward to welcoming Madame Payette in the coming weeks. I would like to take a moment to recognize the exceptional contribution of His Excellency, the Governor General David Johnston, for his years of enlightened service and leadership to our country. Nous lui souhaitons, ainsi que son Excellence Madame Johnston, nos meilleurs voix et souhaitant le gouverneur général désigné la réussite et le plus grand bonheur dans ses nouvelles fonctions. Nous avons aussi eu, le 1er juillet, le grand plaisir de recevoir à Rideau Hall leur Altesse royale, le prince de Galles et la duchesse de Cornouailles pour l'inauguration de leur entrée de la reine. Cette visite tombait à un point puisque la rénovation de l'avant-cour au complet de Rideau Hall avait été inaugurée en juin. This is also a time of transition at another official residence as we prepare to welcome the Honourable Andrew Scheer, the leader of Her Majesty's loyal opposition and his family to Stornoway. I would also like to mention once again the Confederation Pavilions Initiative, which is a signature project for the NCC for Canada's 150th. These architectural and historical treasures of the capital have received more than 120,000 visits so far this summer. I've mentioned at our last meeting that we were pleased to inaugurate the International Pavilion at the new building at 7 Clarence Street with a splendid exhibition presented by the Embassy of the Federal Republic of Germany. Since then, it has also hosted an inspiring exhibition by the Embassy of Ireland, celebrating the contributions of Irish Canadians to the building of our country. And we encourage everyone to visit the current exhibition presented by the Embassy of the Kingdom of Belgium, a very moving exhibition produced in conjunction with the Canadian War Museum. The remainder of the year, we'll see exhibitions mounted by the embassies of Hungary, the Republic of the Philippines, as well as the delegation of the European Union to Canada. Au Parc Jacques-Cartier, la Maison Charon, le pavillon des auteurs a ouvert ses portes le 12 juillet et restera ouvert jusqu'à la fin novembre. J'aimerais remercier l'Association des auteurs et auteurs de l'Outaouais et la Bibliothèque et Archives Canada pour l'excellent travail de partenariat. And if you haven't had a chance to visit yet, the other pavilions are still open, with the exception of the Winter Pavilion, which will open later this year with the skating rink at Rideau Hall. There are more details about all the pavilions on the NCC's website. The grand opening of Mosaic Canada took place in Jacques Cartier Park on June 30th. It is one of the largest and most impressive celebrations of the sesquicentennial, not just in the capital, but in the entire country. L'idée est venue d'un partenariat mis de l'avant par la CCN et correspond très bien avec notre mandat de jardinière officielle de la capitale. It has been a remarkable partnership and the source of so much pleasure to so many people. It has been attracting an average of 15,000 per day since it opened. It surpassed its goal of 800,000 visitors and in fact broke the 1 million visitors mark this past weekend. And it will stay there till October 15th for those of you who have not had a chance to visit yet. We'd like to hear from residents and visitors who experienced any of the NCC's Canada 150 initiatives. I invite you to fill out the online public survey on our website. You can find it under the heading Celebrating Canada's 150th. Moving on to Nepean Point, the four final proposals for its renewal will be presented at a public vernissage on October 5th. We invite the public to come and share comments on this signature 2017 initiative. There'll also be an online public consultation. We're looking forward to receiving many comments, both in person, online, and all of these comments will be summarized for the jury, which will complete its deliberations in early November. And the final recommendation for the design will be presented here at our November meeting of the board. After many, many years of work, the National Holocaust Monument will be unveiled later this month. Je suis très fier de l'équipe de la CCN qui a travaillé d'arrache-pied pour réaliser ce projet de calibre international tout en respectant les échéanciers de le budget. Je tiens à rappeler que ce projet a vu le jour grâce à une loi de Parlement adoptée en 2011 et que la mise en œuvre avait depuis été confié à la CCN. I think people will be just astonished at this new Capitol landmark, the largest monument created in the Capitol, aside from the National War Memorial. It was designed by a team led by Daniel Libeskind, the Manhattan architect, and included Edward Bertinsky, the Toronto photographer, and the landscape architect Claude Cormier from Quebec. It really is magnificent. Claude Cormier will join us in the Urbanism Lab presentation of the Urban Forum partnership with them to present the work of Monsieur Cormier on the evening of September 27th. So invite the public to come and meet Claude Cormier, the wonderful landscape architect who has created this great environment. Our fifth priority is to be a value-added partner in support of Canada's capital region. I would like to thank very warmly Nokia for partnering us again to present the Sunday Bike Days. The 47th season was a great success. It's become one of the capital's great summer traditions. Particularly special this year was the inclusion of Confederation Boulevard on opening day, where all of Confederation Boulevard was closed for cyclists. It was very popular, so there's an analysis underway to see if this could be made a legacy event for the 150th, to have one day a year, and we'll talk about that at future meetings. As well this year, a new generation of entrepreneurs between the ages of 5 and 17 took part in a pilot project encouraging them to operate small kiosks along the parkways, selling everything from lemonade to dog biscuits, t-shirts, mugs, bracelets, and even superhero capes. J'aimerais aussi remercier notre partenaire GIA Ottawa pour nous avoir aidés à offrir gratuitement des ateliers au labo d'urbanisme de la capitale pour initier ces jeunes entrepreneurs au monde des affaires. Je suis heureux que ce programme connaisse une telle réussite et que nous avons été forcés d'ajouter des emplacements le long des promenades pour satisfaire la demande. Un sondage enquête est en cours pour voir ce que nous pourrons améliorer l'an prochain. Once again, the NCC's Archaeology Month activities attracted a significant number of volunteers to digs at Lac Leamy and the Moore Farm. It speaks to the public's fascination with archaeology that so many people come out and participate, but their work also provides invaluable data for the study of the region's past, turning up artifacts from thousands of years ago up to more recent times. La préservation et le catalogue de ces artefacts sont un important volet de mandat d'intendance de la CCN et s'effectuent conformément à un protocole signé avec la Première Nation Algonquin, Pequawkinagan et Kitiganzibi. In just over a week, the fourth season of the Capital Urbanism Lab will be launched with a partnership with the Conference Board of Canada to host a fascinating session about socially inclusive public transportation. One of the special guests will be Professor Karen Lucas of Leeds University in the UK. And as you can see from this slide, the rest of the season is going to be very lively. You can find details on the NCC's website. We'll be touching heritage, public science. We're having a session on imaging the city, looking at three-dimensional models and modeling. We're going to have a session on capital cities and public diplomacy. We're having an interesting session on planning the sky. And so forth. I won't go through all of them, but it's shaping up to be a very interesting season. Our sixth and final priority is to demonstrate corporate excellence such that the NCC is recognized as an exemplary federal crown corporation and steward of federal lands and assets. And this is a theme that our new chair has asked us to strengthen and to look at. I think we've had it in our corporate plan for 2 years now and has led to some improvements, and we're looking forward to pushing this even further. La CCN est engagée à une vision d'accessibilité universelle pour la capitale qui fait partie de son plan de la capitale du Canada. Parmi les nombreux projets, je pourrais parler des améliorations récentes à Mer Bleue qui ont rendu ce lieu merveilleux encore plus accessible aux personnes handicapées. Ce projet, nous avons grandement misé sur la connaissance et l'expérience des membres de notre comité consultatif sur l'accessibilité universelle. We were very pleased to support Bob Brown, who is the vice chair of our advisory committee on universal accessibility, to travel to New York in June to attend the annual conference of states that are party to the UN Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities. I think you can see Bob in this photo on the right, and we've asked him if he would think about giving a presentation to the board on the experience of that conference. So hopefully we'll have that at a upcoming meeting. As well, we were pleased that Mona Lamontagne, a senior architect with the NCC, will be working with the Rick Hansen Foundation to provide input and feedback and to advise the foundation regarding its accessibility certification program, which will promote an accessible and inclusive built environment across Canada for people of all abilities. In fact, it will be, the goal is to make it the lead standard for inclusive design, and I think it will have a global impact if it is successful. There are currently two openings on the NCC's advisory committee for candidates from the National Capital Region, and I encourage anyone with relevant interest and knowledge to apply. The applications for these positions, which will be a three-year term beginning in November, are being accepted through the NCC's website and the LinkedIn page until September 30th. And with that, Mr. Chair, I will end my report.
Merci beaucoup, Marc. Comme vous voyez, ça, c'est juste les trois derniers mois. Ça, c'est une grande liste d'activités, beaucoup de choses qui se passent, et ça parle des gros enjeux et le rôle de la CCN joue dans notre région capitale nationale. I'd like to welcome new members of the media and public who have joined us. Again, just to reiterate, we're extremely grateful and feel very privileged that you would show the interest and the same passion for attending and covering the NCC. Are there any questions for Mark? If not, great. Thank you, Mark. That was an excellent, thorough report, and I can speak from personal experience of participating in numerous of these meetings and activities and events. What a real pleasure it has been, and commend the staff and
the organization for having such a significant impact for Canada 150 and really enhancing our national capital region. So thank you very much. This time, we're going to turn it to regional matters and to His Worship, Mayor Watson.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and good morning. Thank you, Mark, for the reference to Peter Reuter's farm. I know Kay knows the family and the farm, and it's quite a loss to Peter and obviously to the whole community. And my hope is that we can do whatever we can from the NCC to make sure that we're sympathetic to the fact that the loss of both the livestock is a tragedy, but also the barn, and the need, hopefully, if Peter decides to rebuild, that we could be as cooperative as possible to ensure that there are no delays in getting the barn back up, because Peter has been a great contributor to the community. Those of you who have been to Farm Aid and the Mayor's Rural Expo, he's always there with cows for the cow milking contest amongst media and politicians and so on, and he's a great steward of the land. So thank you for referencing that in your comments. The second point is I know that you and others are working on finding a solution for the Hog's Back Bridge. That is always a challenge when it breaks down. It blocks an important artery for Carleton University, for Mooney's Bay, for the Deborah Dines area, and anything we can do to try to find a more permanent solution would be very much appreciated. I know it's an old bridge, and it's probably getting more difficult to find the parts, but I think we need something more long-term for that particular site, because obviously there's fire stations and ambulance stations and so on that use that route as well. Following up on the theme of 2017, just a couple of updates since our last meeting. We had two major events that one Mark referenced was Lemachin. And Lemachin was an overwhelming success in terms of numbers and satisfaction rates and so on. Close to 750,000 people over 4 days took part in that. And for those of you who were not able to see it, we have a short video that was produced just to show you the magnitude of the beasts. Of the Catholic Church and the Supreme Court to hold, put a spider on the Basilica and have a fight between a dragon and a spider on the front lawn of the Supreme Court. But it was one of these moments that I think anyone who witnessed it won't soon forget. And our thanks to all of our partners and federal government, provincial government, our private sector sponsors, and the 3,000 volunteers that we have for Ottawa 2017. Another event that became a signature event and sold out literally within 4 minutes, the tickets went online, was called Canada's Table, which was an opportunity to showcase 10 great chefs from across the country and 10 local chefs. and it was 1,000 people. A former prime minister was in attendance, Joe Clark and his family, and it was one of the most beautiful nights weather-wise that we've had this summer, and we'll just show you a quick video to show you what it looked like. Minister McKenna was there, and the proceeds from that went to various food agency organizations like the Parkdale Food Market and the Ottawa Food Bank, and the chefs in the days up to that were also spread across the city in the Union Mission and Shepherds of Good Hope and other social agencies to prepare meals and offer some courses to the residents of those organizations. So it was a fun event, and it helped a lot of good local charities here in Ottawa at the same time. So we have a number of major events still to come up. We remind people all the time 2017 is not over. There's lots more, including hosting the Grey Cup Festival and the Grey Cup at Lansdowne Park. The NHL, as speaking of Lansdowne, thank you to the cooperative approach of the NCC for getting the sign on Queen Elizabeth Driveway. That makes a big difference to advertise events. It's very tastefully done and has been well received. The NHL Outdoor Classic, celebrating the 100th anniversary of the first NHL game. We work very hard to attract that to Ottawa, and it's coming up in December, as is the Roar of the Rings, which is the largest curling championship, bigger than the Brier because it's both men and women's curling. The qualifying rounds, whoever wins in Ottawa goes on to represent Canada at the Olympics in South Korea. And we have eight or nine more in Ottawa Welcomes the Worlds. This is the program similar to what the NCC has, where we have invited embassies and high commissions to host a one day, or in the case of China, they're going to have 4 or 5 days of activities at the Horticulture Building or the Aberdeen Pavilion. And it's been a tremendous success to date. I think 165,000 people have gone through the doors and tasted cuisine and music and dance and art and tourism opportunities for these many countries whose embassies or high commissions are located here. And finally, we continue to work with our partners on our LRT program. Since our last meeting, the Prime Minister announced the federal government's share, $1.1 billion. The Premier had announced a similar amount a year ago. And the city's funds are in place, and we continue to make progress on that front. And we've had some good meetings with the NCC to resolve any outstanding issue, particularly the placement of the maintenance facility center, which will be farther away from the residential community at Crystal Beach Lakeview. And I know that was well appreciated by residents in that end of the city. So those are just a few of the things that have kept us busy, and we thank you for the opportunity to report on them. Merci.
Well, thank you very much, Mayor Watson. I had the opportunity to participate with you on a few of these activities, whether it was the picnic on the bridge or La Machine. I didn't get to do the crane, dinner on the crane. That looked like a lot of fun, although drove by and I saw these people hanging in the sky, and I was a little bit worried about how they, that turned out beautifully as well. But you also hosted LPGA event this summer. You had numerous activities, and so congratulations to you, and also Mayor Maxime Penneau-Jobin for a great event with Moisic Canada, as you pointed out. It's been a tremendous summer. The weather may not have been great in Ottawa this summer, but man, did we have a lot of fun. It was a tremendously exciting summer and actual year to be in Ottawa, and very, very proud as a Ottawa Gatineau citizen to for all the tremendous Canada 150 activities taking place. So congratulations on that. I'd also like to thank you and Mayor Patineau-Jobin, for your continued participation and engagement on the board. We're extremely grateful and excited to have that, and the deep collaboration that the NCC has with the two municipalities, and the continued fostered collaboration that you're helping to lead and spearhead. So thank you very much. There are some questions, I believe. I know, Mike, you have a question for the mayor.
Actually, it was more of a comment that I'm delighted that he did raise the issue with Hogs Back Bridge, and indicated the city's willingness to help find a solution. Yesterday, the board did as we often do, a field trip of the various initiatives that are underway in the Capital Region, being carried out by the NCC, some on their own and some with partners. And one of the things that really gets hammered home when we make these is the impact of our deferred maintenance deficit. We have bridges, we have roads. These are in place to serve the population of the region, and there's a lot of work that needs to be done on these. Any time that the municipalities are willing to step forth and help us deal with these situations, I think we take advantage of those situations and come up with collective solutions to approach them. So thank you, Mayor Watson, on offering your willingness to help on Hogs Back and others.
Thank you. D'autres questions pour le maire? Okay, sinon, on va bouger pour l'adoption. We're going to move to the adoption of the consent agenda. Do we have a mover? Bob, and seconded by Mike. All in favor? Great. No questions or comments? No, great. Perfect. So now I'd like to invite Jane and her team to come and make a presentation on the National Capital Public Awareness Survey results that were undertaken this past year. So Jane, you'll introduce your guests, and perfect. Thank you very much.
Good morning. It is my pleasure to be here today with Tony Colson, who is Group Vice President with Environics Research Group, to present the results of our most recent public opinion survey. Also here with us is Kirsten Stanzel, NCC's project leader for this study. NCC has been undertaking public opinion surveys for several years, starting back in year 2000, for the most part at intervals every 2 to 3 years. While the questions have varied somewhat with each survey, a core set of questions have provided the Commission with information on residents' awareness of the NCC and its mandate, as well as public attitudes about the NCC's responsibilities and performance. Beginning with the 2014 survey, questions were added to provide information which will continue to assist and complement the NCC's efforts towards proactive communications and increasing the awareness of our stakeholders on not only what the NCC does, but more importantly, how stakeholders can work with the NCC and contribute to building their capital for all Canadians. Equally important, residents' views on what the NCC's priorities should be over the next few years have also been obtained. To the extent possible, how these opinions differed by province and neighbourhood were captured. Just before I turn it over to Tony to take you through the study's results, I would like to mention that for this survey, the decision was taken to divide our sampling period into two waves to ensure the accuracy of its results. The first wave took place in late November, early December 2016, and the second wave took place 2 months later in February 2017. While not all responses differed between these two waves, when they did, care was taken in the report to point them out. Tony?
Hi, good morning. It's a pleasure to be here with you all. Thank you for the opportunity. So I'll just start with a brief overview of the survey methodology. As was mentioned, there were two interviewing periods, approximately 750 surveys completed in each of those, for a total of over 1,500 residents surveyed. And when you look at the overall sample, that provides a margin of sampling error of plus or minus 2.5% at the 95% confidence level, or 19 times out of 20 in more common parlance. And when you look at the subsamples, they're each at about plus or minus 3.5%. So it's very accurate in terms of the sampling. And I'll start with looking at residents' awareness of the National Capital Commission, moving into the results. This slide combines unaided awareness, which means that residents are able to identify the NCC based on a description of the mandate or some of its activities, with aided awareness. And that's who didn't have unaided awareness were told, actually that responsibility falls to the NCC. Now that I've mentioned it, you recall hearing about it. Overall awareness is close to 9 in 10, about 89%. 71% have unaided awareness, 18% aided awareness. So only about 1 in 10 hadn't heard of the NCC at all. And those who were not aware or later in the survey told us they had no familiarity with the organization were not asked some of the subsequent questions. So you'll see I reference those aware of the NCC or those with some familiarity throughout. This question looked at whether residents recalled hearing something about the NCC in the media or through word of mouth recently at the time of their survey. And as you can see, at least half of those with any familiarity said they'd heard or seen something recently about the commission. And that's the highest proportion on record since the tracking began. And it's a significant increase from 2014. So an increase from 29% to 52% who had heard about you, about the NCC. We also asked those who had heard something about the NCC what their impression, what impression it left them with. And so out of those who had heard something recently, just under 4 in 10 say they were left with a favorable impression, which is more, it's essentially consistent with the 2014 result. A slightly smaller proportion, about 3 in 10, say they were left with a neutral impression. And then 3 in 10 said the coverage left them with a negative impression. And so that 3 in 10 is up slightly from 2014. And most of that came from the November-December period. Things were quite different in February, as you can see on the slide. The survey also asked about awareness of opportunities to provide input, so NCC consultations. 40% in this survey report that they were aware of those opportunities, which is also a big increase. It's up from 26% in 2014. So people are becoming more aware of those opportunities. And there's continued growth in actual participation in those sessions, now standing at about 1 in 10, 11% who say they participated, up from 7% in 2014. This question asks for people's overall impression of the National Capital Commission. So again, it's those with at least some familiarity with the organization. And overall impressions are generally similar to 2014. About 6 in 10 have a positive view. 3 in 10 report a neutral impression. And the proportion with a negative view remains quite small. It's at about 9% compared to 7% in 2014. So small proportions of negatives. So these are assessments of the NCC's performance on these three different measures, developing federal government property, planning land use for the federal government, and balancing plans and developments with local municipalities. On the first two, you get about 6 in 10 residents saying the NCC is doing a good or an excellent job, which are both quite similar to 2014. The negatives there are relatively few, about 7-8%. And on balancing plans and developments with local municipalities, 45% of residents now say that the NCC is doing a good or excellent job, which is an increase from 40% in 2014. So positive momentum there. And about 15% only have negative perceptions. Residents were also asked to rate the NCC's performance on safeguarding physical assets of national significance, such as Gatineau Park, the Greenbelt, the pathways, official residences, and the natural environment in the region. And again, similar to 2014, almost 8 in 10 residents feel the NCC does either an excellent or a good job. And here you see only about 4% with a negative perception. This next one was a new question in this current survey, and we asked about the NCC's performance on protecting the environment. 7 in 10 residents feel the NCC is doing either an excellent or good job, with most of the rest saying it's doing a fair job, only about 5% negative. And almost all residents, 94% this year, agree that the NCC has a role to play in making the capital an inspiring reflection of Canada and Canadians, and half of the residents strongly agree with that sentiment, and there's only 5% who disagree to some extent. This chart combines four questions, and they're essentially reputational measures. So close to three quarters agree to some extent that they trust the NCC to make good decisions, and that the NCC shares their values. Just over 6 in 10 agree that the NCC is well managed, although it's notable there that 17% say they're not sure, they don't know enough to say. And then over half of residents, it's 56% now, agree that the NCC does a good job consulting and informing the public and its plans and programs, which is an increase of 8% from 2014, so growth on that measure as well. And that's consistent with the increased awareness of consultation opportunities. So this graph puts the full population on one line and sort of shows you the distribution of perceptions. It starts with awareness and familiarity, and then goes into perception of the NCC. So what you have is 11% who are not at all aware, 12% who are not at all familiar, and 14% who say, I don't know enough about the NCC to make to have an opinion. 7% have a negative view of the organization. 8% say it's doing a so-so job. And then the remainder are positive. 10% very positive, 38% positive. If you put this another way, among those who are familiar with the organization, three quarters are very or somewhat positive, and very few have a negative perception. Now, this map's too small for you to worry about the details, but there's just one point I want you to take away from it, and that is the perceptions of residents, whether they're positive, neutral, or negative, are not clustered as some of the prior analyses have demonstrated. What we see now is more or less a distribution throughout the region of different viewpoints, so it makes it a little more challenging to focus in on one group or the other and say, this is how we can resolve that. But what I think these results demonstrate more so is that that third of residents who are not very familiar with the NCC provide a real opportunity for outreach in terms of raising their familiarity, raising their awareness. And we also see that with increased awareness comes more positive perceptions. This last slide, last results slide, looks at the residents' what they see as the priorities for the NCC to focus on over the midterm, the next 3 to 5 years. And the top three are preserving and maintaining green spaces and heritage sites, which is now at 39%, an increase of 9% over the 2014 result. The responsible development of federal land, and one of the things that was mentioned often was LeBreton Flats, that's now at 20%, also an increase of 9%. And preserving and maintaining the official residences was mentioned by 12% of residents in this survey, which is an increase of 10 points over the 2014 result. So that's coming onto the radar for the local citizens. One other mention here is that involving the municipalities or cooperating more is mentioned by about 6% of residents, which is unchanged from prior results. So that's only about 6% commenting in that respect. So just to wrap up, awareness of the NCC remains high, like close to 9 in 10. most have either a positive or a neutral view of the organization, or they don't know enough to say. And as I was saying, I think these latter groups provide a real opportunity for NCC outreach. The results do show that with increased awareness comes more positive views. Almost all residents agree the NCC has a role to play in making the capital an inspiring reflection of Canada and Canadians. Awareness of NCC media coverage reached a new high in this survey. Awareness of NCC consultations significantly higher than in the past. And where we saw that there were substantially higher negative results in the November-December results, those had recovered and in some cases surpassed the levels seen before by the February results. So that's kind of the overall summary, and thank you very much for your time.
Merci beaucoup, Tony. Est-ce qu'il y a des questions à Aditya? Okay.
A couple of questions and comments. So this survey was done in the greater Ottawa area only, right?
In Ottawa-Gatineau.
Yes.
Capital region.
And also the size of the sample was 1,500.
Correct.
Okay. So I would like to know that why National Capital Commission becomes a Greater Ottawa Capital Commission. Why not we get the national level surveys done? I think we have a unique opportunity as a National Capital Commission because people's interaction and touch with our organization is extensive. It's much beyond 1,500. And I think we have to start thinking that every time they touch us, how we can get an opinion and how we are capturing it, analyzing it, and constantly looking at it, what's happening, than in the old style of hiring a survey companies. You know, I think the world is changing a lot. That's online tools, there are companies which do good job. They have much better, no, I shouldn't say better. There's a much versatile, tools there. We should get into two types of things because we are touching, people are touching us. So we should use both pull and push strategy. Pull is the one where we do Twitter and other things where people will come and get information from us. But we have the names of individuals, people who have been in touch with us. So we should have some online push. And there are tools, various companies, if you go the globally, locally, there are there. So the point is that we should more rely on an ongoing basis and start continuously aggregating our feedback mechanism than engaging an outside agency to do this Greater Ottawa kind of a survey and just to have a very, these are very professional organizations, but this is a small sample. We have a unique opportunity in the online world. Yesterday I was talking to one of our colleagues, Brian. I think it occurred to me that yes, we could have a very good opportunity that on platforms like CPAC or Rogers, we could request them to give us some slots where we talk about what we are doing. It could be a national, it could be a this region or provincially, but that reach will be much more so that not only that we are informing, but we are also provoking people, and we could put a plug in for that, oh, we have this survey going on, this is the site and that. So we could do that. I think we should have some professional bloggers. If you look at the budget we spend on a event like this, but if we can find some professional bloggers and younger ones that we engage them and pay them and they do the blogging for us. And commission write-ups, like big corporations, Mark, you would know that. We pay, I used to work in Bell Canada, we used to pay heavily for some people to write into the media. And there is even the Time magazine, Time will write for you if you give ad for something else, and the next time you see there is an article about you. Not necessarily totally cooked up for you. So I think the point I'm making is that we should really seriously look at how we should use the new tools, new medium. How do we use our push and pull strategy? How do we be in the face of the people through this other public medium, and this should be taken to a new height.
Thanks, Aditya. Kay?
Thank you, Tony. Maybe I missed it because I was immediately went to the graphs when I started to read this. Give me some indication of landline versus cell phone and some of the demographics and whether there's an age or a gender aspect to the results. I don't think I saw that. I was captivated by that very complicated map because I don't know what we've done. I think it's one area like Stittsville, for example, where our results were not very high. And so I'm thinking that's all young families, or a lot of it's young families. So can you say a few words about the demographics?
Sure. So your first question was about cell phone and landline. It was a mix. It was either 25 or 30% were mobile numbers. It's in the main report, all documented. So that's the kind of gold standard for representative surveying these days. So that was well covered. In terms of the demographics of the sample, it was fully representative of the region. But in terms of the results, what we see, it's kind of a multi-step thing, but the easiest way to think about it is those with the least awareness are the least positive about the NCC, and those are disproportionately younger people and people who haven't been in the region as long. So people who've been here longer and are older, more aware and more positive. So the focus for awareness raising, the younger, as you suggested.
Gender?
It doesn't stand out, but anything that's statistically significant is noted in the report. My pleasure.
Your comments on my comments also.
Well, a few things. Why not a national survey? In 2014, we did this local survey last, and then in 2015, there was a national survey. Not sure what the NCC's plans are, but they can speak to you about that. In terms of the idea of getting opinion every time residents touch the NCC, to the extent that residents are prepared to do that, it's a splendid idea. What it provides you is not the same as a representative sample, but it's very useful input. So I leave that to the NCC to consider. Push and pull strategy is marketing, which others here can speak to more than me. I'm the researcher. But generally, your comments are sound, and over to the NCC.
Yeah, I mean, this is one tool that we have, and we have many other tools, and actually at our strategic retreat, we'll talk a little bit about communications and about marketing and so forth, so we'll have a chance to fill you in, but this has been a useful tool. One of the good things about this is because it's been repeated for so long, you can see the stability of the results through calm and heavy weather, and it's interesting to see that, and we're grateful for that support. But it's also a good tool for us as we go into the strategic planning session to know where to concentrate on improvement and so forth. But we'll also bring to your attention other tools and our other dashboards and so forth. So I'm sure you can provide us further advice, but we'll give you a greater picture of that later in the week.
Can we have on Denis, and ensuite Brian?
Yeah. What is the overall population of Ottawa plus Gatineau?
Yeah, it's around 1.3 million.
So you're using 1,500 for 1.3 million people. From a mathematical point of view, it's not valid. Because you can cut, and we discussed this 3 months ago. I recall, you have much more capability to go deeper inside the population and get something more precise. So this is my point. This is too small. And with the kind of question we're asking, people that are not happy with the NCC, they won't answer. Crack on the cell phone. Go away. No? You know that business,
So mathematically, there's a 95% chance that the results I read to you are within 2.5 points, plus or minus, of what the population would be. So in 19 out of 20 samples, these results would be within 5 points of what I've presented to you. That's statistical theory. It's based on random probability. These samples are the best that are attainable in the current environment. So I disagree about the sample being too small. It's sufficient for these purposes. It provides accurate reflection of the mood. Certainly a census would be more accurate, but it would cost thousands of times more.
I'm not trying to be tough, no. But I think with all the technology we have now, we can push, you know, more inside.
Stability over the years. Yeah.
Tony, this is a standard polling practice. Yeah. Okay, thank you. Merci, Denis. Brian? And then, Brian, to cut. Carol?
I understand from my background that this is statistically valid, but I think there's some useful information there in terms of our prioritizing and with that good sample, seeing where the priorities of your sample group have changed from 2014 is really good information for us to have going into our strategic planning. I'm not too thrilled with the word stability of results because I would like to hope that we would improve results rather than have stable results. I guess we're not going backwards is the best you can say. The other point I want to speak to is the point that Aditya made, that this is the National Capital Commission. And as someone who comes, I think the Ottawa Citizen called us, comes from the hinterlands, or the Ottawa Sun, or whatever the paper is, I don't know. Anyway, with due respect to the people from the media, I think that there is so little knowledge out there past this area of what the NCC does, and that there are so many opportunities that we don't tap into. I mean, I'm an inveterate reader of the Globe and Mail. I don't ever remember seeing, which is one of the major national newspapers, I don't ever remember seeing anything about the NCC or what the NCC does, which I think is really unfortunate because I do, having been here for 2 years, believe we've done a huge amount. And so my point is not really so much to you, but I think we as a board need to think about how do we make not just people within the Ottawa-Gatineau area aware of what we do, but all of the taxpayers who contribute to our funding in Canada aware of what we do and the wonderful place that Ottawa-Gatineau is. And I think there is, our chair spoke about collaboration, and I think there's a real opportunity for us to collaborate with the cities, with the area, in terms of saying, here's all the wonderful things that happen in Ottawa. Here's all the wonderful things that you can bring your, come to Ottawa. It's your capital. It's not, you know, it's not, the people of Ottawa-Gatineau are obviously the primary stakeholders, but still there's a real, and I know this is probably not the year to say it when you've been so, had such an influx of tourists to Ottawa, but I do think that we need somehow or other to figure out a way to make the rest of Canada aware of what's here. And I know our CEO meets with the MPs and tries to talk to them about what we do. I think that's a step forward, but I think we need to figure out a way to move forward with greater awareness for the rest of Canada, to find ways to be in the national media, to find ways to make Canadians aware of what happens here, because I can assure you that anyone I talk to has, unless they've lived in Ottawa, really don't have any idea.
Thank you, Carol. Mike?
Mr. Chair, I just want to make a couple of points here. As directors, we see information like this, and we're going to say, wow, look at that negative. How do we improve it? And I think that's our role. Our role really isn't to pat ourselves on the back on stability or where the results are strongly positive. But these results are strongly positive. And I think that that is, as Carol puts it, a message that, and as the teacher puts it, that is a message that we can get out there. And I think that in our discussions yesterday from one of the tables with the big ideas, their comment was, we do a lot, but we don't tell anybody about it. And that, I think, is something we should do. That may assist some of the new citizens to the Ottawa area, get a better understanding of who we are. I think there will always be people who, just as they don't like McDonald's, you know, the NCC is going to be held at that level regardless of what we do, and you know, so be it. But recognizing that we have areas to improve, let's not forget that there are politicians in the world who would be delighted to be rated as positively as the NCC is.
Thank you, Mike. Any other questions or comments? We got Bob.
Thank you for the presentation and the report. I think this is an extremely valuable tool to the NCC. It helps us gain insight into our objectives of being a strong regional partner. You know, I think that this focus on this particular study is on our relationship within the region. I imagine it'd be a different type of set of questions and study if we were doing something more nationally. So this is but one tool in a big toolkit. So I think there's great value in terms of us looking at our goal of regional partnership as well as corporate excellence. You know, if it's not worth measuring, it's not worth doing. And if you can't measure it, you can't manage it. So, you know, I support this initiative. It's a motivational tool, I think, for the board, for staff, for the organization as a whole, to know that these accountability documents that come forward, I think helps to sharpen the organization. And it's a decision-making tool as well when we see the priorities. I don't know what the cost of this is, but my sense is it's best practice to do this on an annual basis as opposed to every 2 or 3 years. And perhaps this question is for our CEO as to whether your thinking is whether this is something we could do to commit to on an annual basis as part of our, you know, we have an annual report, we have an annual public meeting, the board does this annual retreat. I think it's good information for us to have. As opposed to doing it on a I won't say sporadic basis, but I think you've said every 2 to 3 years or something, so it's not fixed in a schedule. I'd ask our presenters, but it would be a business development opportunity for them if I said, is it a good idea to do it every year? So maybe I'll direct the question to you, Mark, to see what your sense is as to whether the value of this is and the value of having it on an annual basis.
Well, first of all, I do think it's valuable, and I think consistency in approach is valuable in surveying because you can look back and have a longitudinal perspective on the results. I think stability in the results, I mean, of course, we want to improve, but we live in a hurly-burly world where issues come on us, and one came on us at the sampling time. It was very interesting to see how the support stayed in place essentially through that period. We have a very small research budget for a corporation of this size. I mean, it's a budget I'd love to expand, not so much for opinion research, although that could be something we would build, but all kinds of research I think would be helpful to the board, and it's something I'd like to talk about a little bit at our strategic retreat, is if we could find some ways to have some more funding, because Jane really has a tiny budget, and Kirsty really, for a size of our corporation, I think it's an under-resourced area. So at the moment, we wouldn't have resources to do an annual. What we have been doing is alternating our focus on the region and the national survey so that we can have a perspective outside of the region. And so I think, Tony, you're right, the last national survey we did was 2015, so we'd be due to do that again. Our chair has also made a suggestion to focus on a stakeholder survey, a more detailed survey of a broad series of stakeholders. And so we may, for 1 year, take the resources and do that because we wouldn't have additional funds to do that. So I think this is a good subject to discuss at the retreat. I don't have a definitive answer. I'm always for more research, but on the other hand, we have financial pressures all over the place. So I wouldn't say it's easy for us right now to expand our research budget without thinking through where we would get the funds to do that.
Basil, and then Vikar.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just to follow up on some of the comments Carol and others have made here regarding getting our message out across the country. The meeting's coming up in the next few weeks, the next couple of months across the country by a National Capital Commission. I know in our small province of PEI, the birthplace of Confederation, the interest is really getting out there and people are looking forward to attending those events there in PEI. And I think as we move across the country for the other meetings, it was announced four or five other meetings, that's going to help get the message of the National Capital Commission and the capital city here, the national capital, get the message out across the country very positively, in my opinion. Thank you.
Thank you, Basil. Very good point. The last word will go to Victor.
Très intéressant, le niveau d'études qui a été fait et les statistiques parlent d'elles-mêmes. Il reste qu'il y a peut-être moyen d'aller plus loin, puis peut-être qu'on va en discuter encore, mais je suis très surpris de voir que, en général, si on mettait un pointillé sur la rivière de l'Outaouais, les réponses étaient plus positives sur le côté du Québec que sur le côté de l'Ontario, et étaient plus positives, plus proches des villes, puis moins positives quand on s'éloigne des villes vers les milieux ruraux, dans certains cas. C'est peut-être pas juste le profil des utilisateurs, mais c'est peut-être les services qu'ils reçoivent. Par exemple, le parc de la Gatineau a peut-être influencé vers les réponses positives, ou des litiges de transport en commun ou d'accès routier ou autre ont peut-être influencé négativement dans d'autres cas. Donc, ce n'est pas nécessairement le profil des utilisateurs qui fait qu'on est très satisfait ou moins satisfait, c'est peut-être la localisation géographique aussi. Puis moi, quand je regarde les cartes que vous avez avec beaucoup de couleurs, là, je m'intéresse beaucoup à aller un peu plus loin dans l'analyse géographique des répondants.
Merci, Victor. Je pense qu'il y a un certain point que tu dis. C'est sorti dans les données que le plus de connaissances ou plus d'utilisation de la CCN, le plus positif que les réponses. Donc, c'est un enjeu certain qu'on doit continuer à évoluer. I'd like the observation when we observe some of the data around media engagement, and we're very fortunate. We have five or six media members of the media here. As I said, a lot of organizations in the National Capital Region would be are very envious of that media coverage. And I think it's reflected, and I think that's a step in the, if you see some of the results and sort of the trajectory of being open and transparent and having our the media and the public invited to our meetings is very beneficial, not just for the NCC, but also for our citizens to be able to be more informed and aware of what's happening within the National Capital Commission. That being said, there's a consistent theme that Aditya and most of the members raised and came across last night as well at the annual general meeting. And it's an opportunity, and it's the opportunity of being on what we see is where they're informed, they're positive, but there's 37% of the population that doesn't feel that level of information, and that's our goal, and I think part of the consistent message we've had around storytelling, certainly my own experience having been onboarded, feeling that I knew the organization really well and recognizing that I, there was a lot more that the NCC does and the impact that it has, and I think it's a great opportunity for us to be much more intensive in our storytelling. I think that's we've consistently been hearing that, and that's an opportunity. So I think it's a great opportunity. It's not a challenge. It's an opportunity, and it's a challenge in the sense for the organization to continue to evolve our storytelling and our communications. But otherwise, thank you very much, Jane, Chris.
Kirsty and Tony for the presentation. Thank you very much for the board members for their engaged questions and comments. And we'll now turn it over to Dan Champagne.
Monsieur Chair, a petite pause pour 5 minutes.
Well, we're 5 minutes ahead of agenda. Here's what I was going to propose, is if I was going to suggest that if Dan is able to do his environmental strategy in the next within his time allocated of 30 minutes, we'd be then we would take a 10-minute break at that point in time if we're able to keep progressing through the agenda as we have. So we'll ask Dan and Katie Paris to come and present on the update on the environmental strategy. Dan, tu vas introduire tes collègues? Oui, parfait. Merci.
Alors, bon matin, Monsieur le Président, premier dirigeant, membre du Conseil. Je me présente, Daniel Champagne, directeur général de l'aménagement de la capitale. Avec moi aujourd'hui, j'ai Katie Paris, qui est le directeur d'environnement et de transactions immobilières ainsi que le développement, et aussi Geneviève Mercier, qui est l'officier senior en environnement du contexte stratégique. The following will be in English. The NCC's environmental strategy has been providing a focused agenda for environmental leadership in Canada's capital, and it supports the corporation's strong tradition of environmental stewardship. This strategy also contributes to the three strategies or the three strategic pillars of the plan for Canada's capital: meaningful capital, second, the picturesque and natural, and also thriving and connected capital, which are all related to sustainability. In June, we presented the 2016-17 Annual Environment Report to you and noted that we had started renewing the environmental strategy. I'll now turn it over to Katie Paris, who will provide you with an update on our progress and also new developments as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Danielle. And I'd just like to acknowledge Geneviève Mercier, who's really been the leader of this process. So you can ask questions afterwards and she may be able to respond. So by way of background, as you know, we've had an environmental strategy since 2009. It was really a leadership document when it was created then. It expires next March. This strategy was created internally. It was an internally driven and voluntary approach to doing better on the environment. It supported the incorporation of environmental issues into our policies and practices and really gave us all a series of targets and objectives to work toward together. So, I didn't even give you the slide for all of that. There you go. So we, in conjunction with Jane's group, the audit group, took a look at this current strategy, doing a review with an outside consultant who did a series of surveys and interviews to find out more about the effectiveness and the relevance of the current strategy. And the results were largely very positive. So the study found that the strategy was really relevant to the NCC, that it was aligned with our mandate, and largely was successful in the sense that 16 out of the 23 objectives that we set were achieved. The results on the current strategy are reported annually. It's very transparent so the public can see year to year how the NCC is doing. That review also found some areas that could be improved and which we intend to address in the renewal of the strategy. For one thing, the strategy could have been better integrated with other corporate planning processes. So, for instance, you got an annual environmental report in June. That was separate from our corporate annual report. Going forward, we hope to be able to make those processes basically work together. Roles and responsibilities in the current strategy weren't always systematically identified, so accountability for results became a little problematic. There was a lack of dedicated budgets, for instance, for those different objectives, so simply resources tended to be a constraint to achievement of certain objectives. And finally, it was observed by many who were interviewed that a shorter time frame for an environmental strategy would be preferred. So 9 or 10 years is probably too long to let one strategy continue without renewal. So having said all that, we set out to do some consultations earlier this year.
We went out externally and internally. So we started internally in February with the staff. Roughly one-third of the staff attended a series of workshops and consultations and really helped build for us the vision for this new strategy. In June, we also had workshops with regional stakeholders and members of the general public to give us their feedback in a series of open houses and workshops. We got a lot of great ideas, the majority of which are really aligned with our current strategy and with the goals of the overall government's federal sustainable development strategy. And that's where I'd like to turn, as there's been a significant change in our process that has to do with that sustainable development strategy. So on June 19th, Minister McKenna, the Minister of Environment and Climate Change, introduced Bill C-57, which proposes amendments to the Federal Sustainable Development Act. The intention of these amendments is to bring greater accountability and really move from kind of planning to implementation in terms of the overall government's approach to sustainable development. It expands the number of federal agencies reporting under the Federal Sustainable Development Strategy from 26 organizations to more than 90, of which the NCC will be one. So we are now required to report annually under the Federal Sustainable Development Act, which is an opportunity for us. The implications for the NCC is that really we're going to need to adjust from going from managing an internally driven and voluntary approach to environmental leadership to one of compliance and reporting on the overall government's objectives with regard to sustainable development. So given that, we're recommending that we simply adopt the Federal Sustainable Development Strategy framework as our strategy. So we will no longer go forward with a different internally driven environmental strategy and a report on sustainable development strategy. It will be one thing, and we would even suggest moving our language, the way we speak about this, from the environment to sustainable development. Again, in line with the overall government's direction. The challenge for us then is going to be to contribute to the relevant FSDS goals, targets, and milestones, and I'm going to get to what those goals are in the next series of slides, and to better integrate these goals and our progress into our overall corporate planning and reporting process. So here's a bit of a hierarchy on the FSDS. The vision of the Sustainable Development Strategy is simple. Canada is one of the greenest countries in the world, and our quality of life continues to improve. That's the vision. Very simple, a school child could memorize it. It has a series of principles underpinning it. The principles are the kinds of things you'd see in any modern management framework. Transparency, accountability, public participation. The precautionary principle, the idea that you can't wait for perfect information to take action on things that could create permanent impacts. Reconciliation with Indigenous communities. And integration and collaboration with other departments. So these are all the sort of overarching principles of the FSDS. There are 13 aspirational goals, which I'll present in the next slide. Associated with each goal is a target, a specific target, and a responsibility to a particular ministry within the federal government. Associated with each target, then, is an action plan and other contributing actions that the government would be obliged to, that each ministry is responsible for. So here we have the goals of the FSDS. I'd like you to notice these goals are no longer about, you know, emitting fewer toxins or doing less clear cutting. It's really the positive vision for the future that the government has set out. What is the vision? Pristine lakes and rivers, safe and healthy communities, clean growth, modern and resilient infrastructure, and so on. So these are positive high-level goals. So like I said, with each of those goals, the overall government has set out some targets. Most of those targets, I'm going to be honest, are not that relevant for the NCC because they're really for the whole government. We need to articulate our contributing actions, the way that we can contribute to each of these goals. Currently, by our estimation, we're contributing to 10 of these 13 goals. Under our current strategy. So we're doing these things already. I'll just note that the three that we're not contributing to currently, we probably will continue not to contribute to. Healthy coasts and oceans by virtue of our geography. Clean growth is not about renewable energy specifically. It's really about the government funding research into new technologies. It's not our role. And clean drinking water is a municipal responsibility, and this goal really has to do with the North in providing better, cleaner drinking water to Indigenous communities. So we probably are going to continue not to contribute to those, but the other 10 we are going to, again, through this renewal process, articulate the ways that we can contribute to those goals. So I'm going to run through roughly five of the goals. For your information, in your submission, we've detailed all of those 13 goals in a series of tables, starting on page 10, if you want more information. And I'll essentially go through the targets and what we're currently doing and what we could be doing in addition for each of those goals. So, effective action on climate change. This goal really is about reducing Canada's overall carbon footprint as a country. So the target is to reduce by 30% our greenhouse gas emissions by the year 2030. That's from a 2005 baseline. This goal is really about, for the whole government, participating in international forums, policy development, adaptation, mitigation, all kinds of things, right? We actually do contribute to these things already. So we host significant scientific research on climate change on our lands, in particular Mer Bleu, which is a sort of living lab. And we also provide, I think significantly for this region, an extensive active transportation network in the region that in some ways helps to mitigate the carbon footprint for commuting and other activities in our region. What else could we be doing? So I'm going to review in terms of the ideas, the things that we've already been hearing in our consultations. So one of the ideas is to create a climate change adaptation plan for the National Capital Region. Low carbon government is another goal. Now, this is sort of the marquee goal. This is where the government is committing itself to reduce its own carbon footprint by 40% by 2030 from that 2005 baseline. I would note that the government has already reduced by 19% over that 2005 baseline its carbon emissions. So it's already about halfway to that goal. A little bit about our greenhouse gas footprint. So the overall government's greenhouse gas footprint is 1.1 million tons of carbon equivalent. The biggest emitter in the federal government is DND with 680,000 tons of carbon equivalent. PSPC, 177,000 tons. The NCC, 2,800 tons. Now, we are still, strangely, pretty highly ranked in terms of government departments, in terms of our carbon footprint. The Center for Greening Government at Treasury Board, I've been speaking to them, and they, you know, they're going to be looking at the most high impact reductions in the whole government of Canada, and we probably are going to be caught under that. So we are, I think, going to be adopting that target of 40% by 2030. We have already reduced our carbon footprint by about 12% since our baseline year, which was 2011-12. We need to go back and calculate our 2005 baseline. So I'd say I think this is good news. I think that this is an achievable target. It's something that we can focus on and we have been focusing on. Of our 2,800 tons, about half is official residences of that. A little over half is official residences. 40% of our carbon footprint is Rideau Hall. Of the remaining half, the vast majority of that is Ontario urban lands and other facilities like this building. Quebec facilities contribute virtually nothing because the grid factor there is near zero in terms of carbon. And our fleet is roughly 9% of our footprint in the most recent calculation. This building is about 20% of our footprint. So that just gives you a rough idea of the kind of layout for us. We don't report on our leased buildings. We don't have to report on a number of things like business travel, employee commuting. That's all outside of the protocol that's set out for us by the federal government. So currently, these are just some examples. This is not a thorough list. We have just recently, in the last year or two, completed a geothermal heating and cooling system at Rideau Hall. We expect significant results in terms of the reductions there at Rideau Hall. We have an ongoing retrofit program for residential and commercial buildings. When leases are vacated, we come into those buildings and do blower door tests and make sure the insulation and the windows are up to standards. Other ideas for low carbon government, I think the big visible one is a carbon neutral or even net positive 24 Sussex. A retrofit to the Gatineau Park Visitor Center as a sustainable design model. And the implementation and support for district energy projects here in downtown. Sustainably managed lands and forests. This is a goal that's really about conserving biodiversity. The target right now for the overall government is conservation of 17% of terrestrial areas in the inland water as protected conservation areas. Currently, this is obviously, squarely in the center of our mandate. We are doing a lot in this goal already. We have a corporate natural resources stewardship action plan, and we have already designated all of our high-value ecosystems and habitats according to the standard categories of the International Union for the Conservation of Nature. Additional ideas that we heard through our consultations would be to apply a natural capital model to our decision making to really understand better the benefits and trade-offs of conservation, and to create additional citizen science programs to improve scientific research, data collection, and education. Sustainable food, another big target for the government. There are several targets for this, but the primary one is to ensure a safe and accessible food supply. The NCC is already working on this goal with partners to increase sustainable food production in the Green Belt and on urban lands, for instance, with community gardens. And another example is our lease to Just Foods in the Green Belt that supports local farmers, education, and outreach on sustainable food. We could do more. We could have more urban gardens. We could do more in the Green Belt. We could promote innovation and sustainable practices. Connecting Canadians with nature is another target to increase the number of Canadians that get out into nature and to increase their participation in conservation activities. Currently, we're offering many facilities and infrastructure for outdoor activities, whether that's camping in Gatineau Park, our extensive trail networks, our conservation areas. We also offer outdoor experience programs for youth and new Canadians. I saw recently a great article in The Lowdown, our esteemed newspaper from Chelsea and Wakefield, that recounted a wonderful camping program for Syrian refugees on our lands, partly sponsored by the NCC. So additional ideas would be to make outdoor experiences on NCC lands even more accessible for all Canadians, lower-income Canadians, new Canadians, maybe additional shuttles such as the pilot we've had as the in the Fall Rhapsody, having shuttles to the Gatineau Park. Or to develop additional programs to engage schools, clubs, and citizens, such as the program that Genevieve runs at Mud Lake to remove invasive species in collaboration with citizens and schools. People love these things. They love to be able to get out on our lands and engage in these conservation activities. So just a quick summary of the risks that we're managing on this. The primary one is adequate resources to implement the recommended contributing actions to the FSDS. Another risk is falling short in our contribution to those targets that we've set. And staff and stakeholder buy-in. And this one, we're working hard to, recognize the achievements in this organization we're already making. Develop our ideas through the tools that we have, such as the Urbanism Lab, engaging more people in this discussion, and creating strong liaisons with our municipalities and other stakeholders. Next steps, then, imminently we'll be engaging a sustainability consultant to help us with the more technical aspects of the target setting and best lessons learned from externally. This fall is we're going to be rolling up our sleeves and creating those contributing actions in a series of working groups internally. and consulting with external stakeholders. Going back out to external consultations next winter and spring, and the creation of a communication plan around the FSDS. It's worth noting that the reporting tools given by the government on the FSDS are pretty bureaucratic, a little bit technical. They're not very inspiring. It's not storytelling, so we need to be able to do that ourselves. And then finally, the launch of the new sustainable development strategy in the summer. From 2018 onward, we'll be doing implementation, monitoring, and tracking our results with voluntary annual reports in 2018 and 19. And then once the bill reaches royal assent, we will be tabling our own strategy to Parliament in 2020 and beyond. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Katie. And we have questions. Kay?
Just on your last comment, the bill hasn't, of course, gone through the House at this point in time, but once it does, then the first tabling will be 2020.
That's right.
And then will it be annual tabling and appear before the appropriate standing committee to either defend or to comment on it, or is it just a straight tabling?
I believe it's just a straight tabling in conjunction with other reporting agencies.
Yes. But, of course, any parliamentary committee, if they wanted further, they could call you to appear before them to defend your report at any time. Okay, thank you.
Yes, we have Mayor Watson, then Brian, and then Mike.
Thank you. Excellent report, Katie. Just 2 points. With respect to, I think I'd raised this once before, do we have any requirement when a festival takes a place on LeBreton Flats or Confederation Park, requirement for proper recycling and so on? Is that something that has been looked into? As often you go to these festivals and the garbage cans are overflowing with pop bottles and cans and so on that are not going into the recycling stream.
The large events that are held on our lands are actually through the permits. They are required to put in place sustainable practices. For the smaller events, our teams are like working closely with them and we're looking at various initiatives. But yes, we're looking into that.
Okay. The second point is with respect to community gardens. I recall about 2 years ago, before you were here, my colleague Mark Taylor, who's the counselor for Bay Ward, had a group that wanted to set up a community garden on some NCC land, and there seemed to be a really long process, and I think they just gave up. Now, I would encourage you, because I don't have all the information, or maybe Mark, you might recall, it seemed they wanted, you know, insurance and liability waivers and so on to set up basically a patch of land. I like the fact that you said we should help to facilitate on page 7 here more community gardens, because we've done a lot on our land by adding more community gardens, and they're great. Even at the Innovation Center at Bayview Yards, there's a community garden, and I was told yesterday there are seniors from the Mechanicsville area are coming and helping to weed and, you know, pluck the tomatoes and everything, and it's become a real social outing for seniors who often are isolated. So, you know, I like the idea that we have more community gardens. I just don't want us to put that out and then people have the same experience that this group had in Bay Ward somewhere, where it seemed to take forever to get it. So I don't know, Mark, do you recall that when Mark Taylor
Yeah, I recall it clearly. And first of all, the NCC had a long history with community gardens through the 70s and in various revisions to policy and budget pressures and also an idea of focusing on core mandate that long ago, decades ago, was dropped. There was a big department here that encouraged that. In recent years, philosophy has been to undertake municipal-like activities only where the municipality doesn't have the land resources to do it themselves, and there's nothing inimical to the mandate. And so when Councillor Taylor came forward with his request for a community garden, we took it very seriously. We brought it through very quickly. This board approved a policy on community gardens, which was to have initially a pilot on each side of the river to start bringing back in a more focused way the earlier tradition of community gardens. And with due respect, it was the city administration who couldn't support that at the time with the necessary resources. So we approved it, and it's in the minutes of the meeting that we approved it. And I think it was within the department, the relevant department of the city, they had their own priorities with respect to community gardens. That's my recollection. We can go back and look into it, but certainly in my memory, we took all the steps, and I remember speaking at length with Councillor Taylor, even about trying to arrange an announcement and so forth, and the permission was not forthcoming. So, I think since then, there has been evolution on that. I've lost the detail of it, but I thought in the end that they had been successful, but maybe Katie.
I think they have been, but I'll check that. I'll check into it. But I think that garden is finally a go.
Yeah. I don't have a recollection of the city's involvement because it was your land. So I'm not sure what approval the city needed to give the NCC. There was a community group that wanted to put a plot on NCC land. So I'm not sure what role the city would have in. You know, was there a request for funding for it? I'm not sure. Yeah.
But why don't we look into it and we'll come back with a report, because it's a bit hazy in the memory. But certainly I felt we expedited an approval by the board quickly at the request of Councillor Taylor, and it would be in our minutes. And we have a policy for community gardens now, so we encourage them. And we'll see in the sustainability strategy how to structure that going forward in an appropriate way, which will necessarily involve a good relationship, a collaborative relationship with the municipalities involved.
Okay, so we have Brian and then Mike.
thank you. Just as an observation, and this gets back to communications with average Joe public out there. When I go through this, and certainly, I guess you got to cap how much detail you put into these things, but I think there's some interesting things in here that a little more information would be helpful. On page 4, for example, you talk about, as part of the Corporate Natural Resources Program, over 35 research projects are completed to gather scientific knowledge to support decision-making and better management of NCC. I don't know what those were, but you know something? If we had, as we heard last night, a little more interaction in getting messages out to the public, they would understand some of this stuff. What scientific researches have we done to show support, or where there's some challenges in the Green Belt or in the bog or Gatineau Park or wherever, so we don't get sidetracked by individuals coming in and they're more forceful to make an argument swing this way or that way, and we sometimes miss the neutrality of something. I don't know if I'm making myself understood, but one of the challenges, when I'm out there walking around, and I live here, folks, I rub shoulders with people who are paying taxes here day in, day out, just like everybody else, and the whining and complaining I'm out there, there's a little more out there than what your survey shows in terms of comments and how the NCC performs and other government in general. But I think a little more information and some of the little subtle things that help steer us to making policies, if that was put out there, this is how we arrived at it, and it's not a surprise or a shock, so that the papers don't take it, turn it into a headline, and drive it from a negative point of view, rather than, this is the background research that we've got that help us go towards these, and especially on environmental issues. For example, what do you mean when you say, a total of 117 contaminated sites have been secured in NCC lands. What do you mean by being secured? Are they still leaching?
Being remediated.
We have sites where we've hauled in more contaminated soil and covered the contaminated soil.
Right. It's secured means either remediated, capped, contained.
In English, what does it mean?
That they're safe to be walked upon, used for the land use that's intended.
Okay, and when you have somebody going through who spends a little bit of time going through our expenditures here and sees the money we're spending to consultants to go out and do analysis of some of these sites that runs into tens of thousands of dollars, what does that mean? Is that an annual thing that goes on? I'm being a little picky here, but I'm trying to stress the point that Joe Public, the average person out there, okay, who makes a decision based on the last headline, isn't always the right decision. I think there's an opportunity for us to give out some more did you know kind of stuff to Joe Public. So they buy into where we're going, and they really do believe that we're doing the best job possible and we have their interests at heart. Yeah. I'll just give you a little anecdote, if I may, and then I won't ramble no more. Yesterday, I found it very interesting. When we're out in our tour yesterday, do you know why we're just cutting? We leave the grass log and we cut it along the parkways? You know why we do that? You ever wonder about, because some people going, what are they doing cutting the grass now and they're still leaving it a foot long? Huh? To prevent the geese from crapping all over the place. Yeah. Which costs us more money in terms of maintenance and lost green space. But little things like that, so these, you may not think of these little questions, but that goes on in the coffee shops around town. Why is there 15 guys standing around a hole looking at it instead of fixing it? You know, there may be other things. So I'm taking it a little bit to the extreme, but I hope you understand where the little guy out there is coming from. There's some other stuff that I think we can be a little more proactive to help explain the broad responsibilities we have at the NCC.
Thanks, Brian. I think it relates to our previous point, some of the discussions we've had around storytelling, communications, and yeah. So thank you. So we have Mike and then Carol.
Thank you for your presentation. It was a good presentation, easy to understand. When we talk about setting up our baseline and then trying to reach the target for it, do we go through a process, or do we need to go through a process of practicality? By that I mean, do we want to, if we're just that far away from reaching our target, and it's going to cost us 10 times more to reach that target than it did to get to that point, are we going to make the decision to spend that money and to get that little marginal increase, or are we allowing ourselves some practicality that says, you know, that last 1 or 2% that we'd need to achieve isn't worth $1 million in order to get there? Is that built into our evaluation?
I think it very much is. The targets and the contributing actions. The contributing actions is sort of a fancy word for what projects are you going to do, what programs and projects. We're going to be engaging all the parts, all the branches of the NCC in developing those things. And there are a lot of people in here very conscious of the, you know, real constraints on resources that we're facing. We want to do the actions that give us the maximum impact for the least amount of money. And we have some very good people in this organization who are thinking about those things. So no, I don't think that we are going to go overboard in tackling the last 1 or 2%. I don't think that that's really a danger in this area.
Thank you, Kitty. Last word goes to Carol.
I love having the last word. First of all, I just want to congratulate you. I think the fact that you can transition to what the federal government wants done so easily is a real indication that we've been on the leading edge in this, and that's what I would... Pardon me?
The right track.
Yes, yeah, so that we really have done very, very well. So I commend you for that. I do have 3 points I wanted to make. The first one, last night, Minister McKenna's, one of Minister McKenna's staff person, people were there, and further to what you were saying, Brian, he's doing his PhD, which, having been an academic for 10 years, we used to say piled higher and deeper, because you really have to write verbosity when you're doing that kind of the thesis thing. And I said, that must be quite interesting to, you know, and with one hat, writing voluminous amounts and then briefing a minister where you have to get everything onto one page, and he said, one page, how about half a page? And I think that's the message when I look at something like this, what Brian was saying, how do we get that message into a concise form where we can toot our own horn, where we can, you know, really say, look at what the wonderful things we're doing, and yet have somebody read it? Because that's what's always the concern when you're sitting next to a minister. Will they read it? Because they don't want, you know, piled higher and deeper. The second point I had is, and this is the auditor in me, on page 5, it says the things that you didn't achieve to the level that you wanted to, but it doesn't then, and I may be somewhere in the report, I didn't see it, but then it sort of doesn't say what you, you know, more precisely measure what you didn't. So it said a goal was, for example, to secure all contaminated sites, to go back to that. So it said, well, there is continuous assessment and management of candidate sites. But for me as an auditor, I want to say, okay, how many are still out there? You know, so I think that at some point, that's the kind of information I would prefer to have is, you know, the exception. I know, Mike, you like to say the positive things, but it's the auditor that really wants to know, you know, where are the risks still? And that is a risk thing, I think, is for us, as far as I'm concerned. But the other, you know, divert 70% of waste, and then it doesn't really say, well, you know, where are we? You know, that's, I would like the measure, was it, can't manage what you don't measure, so that the final thing is, I noticed on one page it said, and maybe you don't want to speak to this now, and I'd understand, explore the potential of NCC lands as a location for renewal energy projects. And I wondered if you could speak to that at all.
On your second point on more information on contaminated sites, I think you maybe chose the one where there is the most information. It's called the Federal Contaminated Sites Inventory. We report extensively on it. It's all public information. So, and that is contained in other sources. This kind of summary document, I wasn't going to get into that kind of detail, but believe me, we've got a lot of information publicly available on what sites we've secured and what we have not secured. Equally, some of that precision has been in that series of annual environmental reports that we've given to the board over the last 8 or 9 years. So some of the story around the waste management processes here are contained there. So I hope it's not sounding like I'm weaseling out of it. This report had a different intention.
In my opinion, these should be standalone documents.
Point taken. And in all of that, I forgot your third question. Renewable energy. It's really to explore whether on some of our lands we could be, benefiting from a lease to a company to put up, solar arrays or do geothermal fields or do other kinds of projects on NCC lands that would be consistent with our mandate, consistent with our planning documents, bring in revenue, offset our energy consumption. So where are those win-win situations?
Great. Thank you, Katie. Merci, Geneviève. Dan, you have the next three agenda items. If you can commit to still wrapping up by 12:30, we'll take Kay's suggestion and take a 5-minute break and return a little after 5 after 11.
Thank you.
One minute warning to get back to our seats and start the meeting. So we're going to proceed with our meeting. La parole est la vôtre. Merci.
Again, good morning, everyone. Today, it gives me great pleasure, we're presenting the final capital illumination plan for approval by the Board of Directors. The capital illumination plan initiative was launched in late 2014 with the intent of developing the first common framework for the illuminating the core area of the Capitol. It is one of the 17 milestone projects identified in the plan for Canada's Capitol 2017-2067. A team of consultants led by Judith Ballant from Lumapraxis Conception Lumière, Alain Guillot from Alain Guillot Lumière, and the MMM Group from Ottawa were retained to provide technical expertise to support the planning team. Broad engagement of key stakeholders and the public supported the development of the plan. The NCC worked on this initiative in close collaboration with the City of Ottawa, La Ville de Gatineau, federal partners, private sector representatives, as well as various interest groups. A broad range of public engagement events also occurred throughout the process, allowing members of the public to provide feedback that directly influenced the concept plan. I'd also like to take this opportunity to thank you for your valuable input, which has guided in the development of this plan. I'll now turn it over to Sophie Atchison, the project manager for this initiative, who is also supported by the Director of Planning, Lucie Bureau. Merci.
Thank you very much. So today I will be presenting an overview of the Capital Illumination Plan. The Capital Illumination Plan seeks to fulfill the following objectives: to enhance the Capitol's nighttime beauty through illumination, to enrich the resident and visitor experience in the Capitol, to promote environmentally responsible lighting practices, and to strengthen collaboration between the various stakeholders involved in lighting in the Capitol, including the City of Ottawa, La Ville de Gatineau, and federal partners such as Public Services and Procurement Canada and Canadian Heritage. The Capitol Illumination Plan is a high-level document intended to provide a framework for decision-making and for the coordination of lighting in the core area. The plan will serve as a tool to support several activities, including the management of existing lighting, the identification of priority lighting projects, the design of new lighting projects, and the evaluation of lighting proposals as part of the NCC's federal land use and design approval process, and at the municipal level through the development approval processes of the City of Ottawa and La Ville de Gatineau. A robust consultation process accompanied the development of this plan. Members of the public had several opportunities to provide feedback on the initiative, including a session at the Urbanism Lab, an illumination workshop to gather preliminary input into the plan content, guided night walks, which provided participants with the opportunity to experience a nighttime Capitol, and an online survey to provide feedback on the draft plan, in which 197 respondents participated. The content for the plan was also developed in close collaboration with stakeholders who provided strong support for the initiative, including the City of Ottawa, La Ville de Gatineau, federal partners, and key interest groups such as Safe Wings Ottawa, the Ottawa Enviro Centre, and local business improvement areas. The study area consists of the majority of the core area of the National Capital Region. The Museum of Nature, at the bottom of your screen, was also included given its role as a national institution and interest in this initiative. A large portion of the study area is under municipal authority. The plan intends to serve a key role as a consensus building tool, and the NCC worked in partnership with the two cities in order to achieve a global vision. The analysis of existing conditions with regards to lighting led to the following key findings. The core area lacks a comprehensive nocturnal strategy. There are limited lighting projects, and they are done on a site-by-site basis rather than in support of a broad vision. There is a lack of legibility and landmarks in the nighttime context. Many of the important daytime landmarks, such as the Rideau Canal locks, Alexandra Bridge, and Parliament Hill, are not showcased at night. Finally, priority in terms of lighting is given to vehicular traffic, while architectural lighting and pedestrian-oriented lighting is secondary. The vision for the plan is as follows. The nighttime capital offers memorable experiences, showcases its distinctive character, and contributes to a sustainable future. The plan is based on six key principles: to adopt responsible environmental management practices, to reveal the beauty of the central capital landscape, to showcase Confederation Boulevard, to strengthen the multiple identities of the capital core area, including its symbolic function, its social and economic function, and the significant presence of natural landscapes, to balance the role of light and the role of darkness, and to collaborate and coordinate in support of a global nighttime image. The plan begins with general guidelines, which were developed for the entire study area. They address various themes, including urban design, sustainable lighting, and health, safety, and universal accessibility. One set of guidelines of particular interest is the identification of categories to consider for dimming or turning off lights at various stages of the night. This has a number of benefits, including reduced energy use, reduced light pollution, and reduced bird collisions. An illumination concept was developed, identifying key physical components of the proposed nighttime scenery for the core area. It consists of two components: the illumination zones and the structuring elements. First, at a global scale, four illumination zones and associated guidelines are identified. The zones focus on architectural illumination and have two key objectives. First, to bring together in a coherent manner the diverse built form of the core area on both sides of the river, and to create a more legible foreground consisting of the iconic buildings of the central capital landscape, shown in yellow on the map on your screen. This would be achieved through a higher amount of illuminated buildings and the dominant use of warmer lighting tones in the foreground, lending itself well to the typical building materials. The plan also suggests the illumination of copper roofs, a signature element of many of the foreground buildings. A visual distinction would be created through the use of more neutral and cooler whites for the first background layer of generally taller contemporary buildings shown in light blue on your screen. The photos show examples of the use of different tones of white in architectural lighting. As we move outwards in the background zones, fewer buildings are illuminated, initiating a progressive return to darkness. The second component of the illumination concept is the structuring elements of the nighttime scenery. First, the dark zones consist of watercourses and green spaces in blue and green on your screen. Lighting should be minimized in these areas while allowing for the illumination of key built form components and pathways, as well as to support events. Four categories of nighttime landmarks are identified. Feature sites suggested as priorities for illumination to highlight their importance and allow nighttime discovery. These include the Alexandra Bridge, the E.B. Eddy Digester Tower, the Rideau Canal Locks, and Rideau Falls. Confederation Boulevard, where we propose to maintain signature lighting and prioritize the illumination of facades. The key nodes, which we propose to reinforce as key entrances to the downtown area and to Confederation Boulevard. And buildings that, given their location and role, are identified as priorities for illumination. Nightlife areas are priorities for future detailed lighting master plans and for creative and artistic lighting projects. They include nightlife centers in yellow on your screen, the Byward Market and Vieux Hall, art and innovation districts in red, the Arts Court District in Ottawa and the Montcalm Cultural Axis in Gatineau, and Spark Street. Finally, two evolving areas are identified, the Chaudière and Albert Island area and Le Breton Flats, for which we recommend detailed lighting master plans given their large scale and key location. The next part of the plan identifies lighting guidelines for common uses in the core area: buildings, historic places, monuments, public art, special projects, roads, and illuminated signage. These are intended to guide proponents and provide consistency in the federal and municipal review of an increasing number of illumination projects. Finally, the sectors provide detailed guidelines for specific sites identified as structuring elements in the illumination concept. Based on the guidelines, conceptual illustrations provide insight as to how implementation may begin to shape the nighttime experience in the Capitol. The panoramas illustrate the potential future way in which the plan may modify views across the river. On the Ottawa side, we can see the result of illuminating all the key buildings in the central Capitol landscape with warm tones, the showcasing of copper roofs, the dimming of internal lighting in background buildings, and the illumination of feature sites, including Alexander Bridge and the Rideau Canal locks. A visual distinction begins to emerge between the foreground and background. On the Gatineau side, the E.B. Eddy Digester Tower, Alexander Bridge, and Museum of History are showcased. Several older brick buildings are illuminated to provide visual continuity along the shoreline, and the contemporary facades of the Kruger plant are proposed to be used as artistic installations for the projection of interpretive content. The nightlife areas are not seen from the long-range views depicted in the panoramas. However, they are very important as areas of nighttime activity. This illustration shows a potential lighting approach for the Clarendon Court, which forms part of the NCC-owned and managed Sussex Courtyards. It provides insight as to the impact a comprehensive lighting scheme may have for this key destination in the Byward Market, which could act as a showcase NCC project. As the instigator of the plan, the NCC plays a key role to bring it into action. The plan identifies several priority illumination projects for the NCC in the next 5 years, including Richmond Landing, Rideau Hall, Nepean Point, Confederation Park, and the Sussex Courtyards. The plan also identifies recommendations for governance, including the establishment of a nighttime landscape governance committee and a lighting charter, a symbolic document signed by key partners of the plan, confirming their endorsement in principle in the recommendations. Finally, we recommend the preparation of an annual implementation report to assess the success of the plan. Should the plan be approved today, next steps include the following: the development of the lighting charter in collaboration with key partners, the development of the detailed implementation strategy, and the development of an annual implementation report. To conclude this presentation, the recommendation before the Board of Directors today is as follows: that the federal land use approval for the Capitol Illumination Plan 2017-2027 be granted, and that the signature of the federal land use approval document be delegated to the Executive Director, Capitol Planning Branch. Thank you very much.
We'll move it to questions, and we have the first one being Mike, and then Victor.
Thank you for the final presentation. This has been a very long process, and it's been a very inclusive process. And I think we have a plan that is going to make a significant difference to how residents and visitors experience Ottawa, the capital region. I just got back from a two-week tour in Scandinavia, and it wasn't until I had that tour that I was able to appreciate the importance of an illumination plan. We talk about nighttime, and you know, here it is summer, so we kind of think about summer nighttime. But the type of illumination that we're proposing in the wintertime will make a drastic impact on how people see the city and how they feel. Once I saw my first nighttime, had my first nighttime experience in Helsinki, I asked the people, what's this all about? And they said, in these long winters that we have, we need light to make us feel good. And I never thought about illumination plan as being part of the health plan of a community. And I think that now I get it. And I think this is certainly going to be at the same scale as we see in some of those northern communities. So congratulations. I'm going to support this. I don't have a question. But I would encourage other members of the board to support it as well.
Thank you very much, Mike. Victor?
Merci, Madame Atchison, pour une présentation bien éclairée. Je voudrais vous demander comment vous allez faire dans les prochaines étapes là, de mise en œuvre pour vous assurer que les riverains du boulevard de la Confédération ne vont pas neutraliser l'effort de la CCN de mettre en place un plan de lumière qui pourrait être en compétition avec les lumières existantes des voisins, en fait, là, les riverains du boulevard de la Confédération.
Je vais répondre en français également. En fait, la CCN a plusieurs outils. Un des outils est notre outil en vertu de l'article 12 de la loi qui nous permet d'approuver tous les projets fédéraux. Donc, lorsque ça sera un projet fédéral, il devra respecter l'ensemble des recommandations de nos plans. Bien sûr, un plan comme ça ne peut se réaliser entièrement sans la collaboration avec les municipalités qui, pour tout le secteur privé, ce sont les municipalités qui sont maîtres d'œuvre. Il y a la charte lumière et il y a une stratégie de mise en œuvre qui va nous permettre de travailler en collaboration avec les deux municipalités, avec Service public Canada, qui a aussi beaucoup de propriétés fédérales. Donc, pour les encourager à travailler dans le même sens que nous et à adapter leur réglementation municipale dans ce sens-là. Donc, jusqu'à présent, on doit dire qu'il y a un large appui de la part de nos collègues des municipalités et de la part de nos collègues des partenaires fédéraux. Tous sont très heureux de voir cette initiative arriver.
Merci beaucoup, Lucie. La question de Victor. La question va être maintenant posée par Denis. Et si après cette question-là, on a Jim. Ensuite, on va bouger un vote pour la recommandation.
Moi, je supporte le plan. Il n'y a pas de problème. C'est très bien. C'est très, très, très bien. Puis il y a des belles images dans ce document ici. La seule chose qui me préoccupe un petit peu, c'est pas un reproche, c'est une préoccupation. Je voudrais pas que la lumière devienne comme des arbres de Noël. Si vous regardez à la page 27 là, du document, on se croirait dans le temps de Noël. C'est pas le but, là. Le but, c'est d'avoir de la lumière qui soit assez... quel mot que je pourrais employer, là? Qui soit assez forte, mais en même temps qui soit... balancé. Hein. Vous êtes sûrement allé à Lyon voir qu'est-ce qu'ils ont fait, là. C'est excellent. C'est excellent. Parce que si on met des lumières comme à la page 27 partout, là, avec des arbres de Noël et tout ça, là, ça va devenir impossible. Hein. Je pense. Mais je ne suis pas un expert en illumination, là, pas du tout. Pas du tout. Mais je supporte le plan à 100%. Il y a des pages qui sont absolument aberrantes. Puis vous allez voir. En implantant les différents concepts, vous allez voir comment ça va, avoir les commentaires des personnes. Mais ce serait malheureux que ça sorte comme un big Christmas tree là, à Ottawa. C'est ça. Ça ne marcherait pas, ça.
Merci, Denis. Si vous avez un commentaire pour ça ou non? C'est juste recommandation. Alors, merci pour la recommandation et Denis. Alors, le dernier mot, ça va être avec le maire Watson.
Merci. Seulement deux questions. One is, we just had a good presentation on the environmental strategy. How does this measure up to our desire to reduce GHGs when we appear to be adding lights? I'm assuming they're going to be LED lights. And have you done any kind of an analysis that all of these new measures to light up buildings are going to be good for the environment? And then secondly, what is the cost for the NCC? I know a lot of these properties are private property or city, but I didn't find a reference to what the cost would be to move forward with the plan on NCC properties. Thank you.
Thank
I mean, definitely one of our key principles supporting this plan is specifically to encourage the adoption of environmentally friendly lighting measures and lighting fixtures. So there's throughout the plan, there's a number of guidelines that support that, including promoting the use of energy efficient lamps, LED lamps in particular at this time in terms of the current technology, dimming lights at night at various courses of the evening. So there are a significant amount of measures that are supportive of that idea. Because the plan is a high-level document, doesn't go into specific projects, we didn't have the opportunity to actually do an analysis of individual impact of specific projects, and that will happen once on a case-by-case basis once the projects are designed. There was a strategic environmental assessment that was done of the plan that concluded that in the whole there would be positive environmental impacts resulting from the plan, and that on a project-by-project basis environmental mitigation measures would be applied.
And the cost to the NCC, did I miss that?
In our plans, this is a strategic plan. The costing will be developed in every year's budgets where we prioritize the projects, and Dr. Christensen will complete.
Yeah, it's a life cycle management thing. I mean, lighting systems have a fixed life cycle, so when replacements come up, whether it's us or whether it's the cities or whether it's private sector, we hope that the replacements will take into account this plan, so that it's not an upfront capital investment that wipes out the systems that still have longevity. That's why it's sort of a 10-year horizon to see the full effect come into force. But one of the great advantages is with all the works projects going on right now that are already orienting themselves to the plan, and we're looking at the parliamentary precinct, the temporary Senate building in the train station, many other projects are already have been through the consultation process aligning. So we think there'll be a good start without having any upfront capital investment. And as we mentioned, all of our projects coming up in the next few years will be designed in accordance with it. Can I go on with a couple of comments, or did you have other?
I think Lisa.
Just recognizing some of the citizens' concerns that showed up in the media around the dark sky, I think that we've done a pretty good job at addressing those, because I think a larger impact is probably the municipal side with street lighting, and I don't know what stage Gatineau and Ottawa is with respect to their street lighting, because that does project a lot of light pollution substantially. So I don't know what efforts they've undertaken to do that conversion to maybe LED. So I think that would have an impact to mitigate some of the citizens' concerns.
Thank you. So before we bring it to vote, any last minute comments, Mark?
Clarifications? Yeah, just briefly, I just remember in 2014 when Joanne Chianello interviewed me, I think in the first interview I had, and she wanted to know what was in my black notebook, and one of the things we talked about was the illumination plan. Well, Joanne, here it is. It's done.
Finally made it.
But it's done due to, you know, really great effort on the part of Lucy Bureau, Sophie Atchison, Chris Hoyt, I don't know if Chris is here, many other people on the NCC staff. Great cooperation from the City of Ottawa, City of Gatineau, so thank you.
Thank you for those comments, Mark. So we're going to bring it to a vote.
I'd move the recommendation.
Thank you. Seconded by Mike. All in favor? Any opposed? So recommendation is carried. Thank you very much, team. Dan, we'll move on to your next item on the agenda. You've made a good way of helping us catch up, and I'd encourage your team to continue to stay on the agenda so we can commit to our 12:30 deadline.
Mr. Chairman, I'd just like to say that the photography in the plan is absolutely stunning. Mm-hmm. If I could frame about 10 of these for my wall at any point in time. Thank you.
Panorama on the cover. The cover is a little weak. The rest of it maybe just doesn't come across.
It's night, yeah.
So, Daniel, la parole est la vôtre.
Encore un bonjour. Merci. Ce matin, ça me fait un grand plaisir de venir au conseil et de discuter aussi de la révision du plan de directeur du parc de la Gatineau et la présentation qu'on va faire. Nous voulons aussi vous présenter à titre d'information le plan d'action et de consultation pour la révision du plan directeur du parc de Gatineau. Cette initiative importante, qui est l'une de nos priorités corporatives, sera co-dirigée par l'équipe de planification à long terme de l'UCI Bureau, ainsi que par l'équipe de l'intendance des terrains du Québec, sous le leadership de Christy Spence. La part des collègues des affaires publiques et notamment des consultations et des communications sera importante pour cette initiative, ainsi que mon collègue Gary Lacey, qui est aussi le directeur général de l'intendance de la capitale. L'intention de cette révision est de donner aux collègues de l'intendance de la capitale un plan qui sera un réel plan du 21e siècle qui répond aux nouvelles tendances en matière de planification des grands parcs naturels tenant compte des besoins des résidents et des visiteurs de la capitale. Christy Spence, Lucie Bureau ainsi que Luc Fournier, directeur des affaires publiques, vous donneront des détails sur l'approche de cette révision. Je passe maintenant la parole à Christy Spence, directrice terrain urbain du Québec, ainsi que du parc de Gatineau. Christy.
Thank you, and I'll get right going. So, the goal of this presentation today is to share with you our plans for the revision, which is planned over a pretty short 18-month window, but also to set the context a little bit, to let you know where we've come from since 2005 and where we think we're heading. A little bit of background, Gatineau Park, I think most people know about it to some extent, but in terms of the NCC, it's really the largest and most substantive green space that we manage. It's 361 square kilometers. Most of that is in natural condition. There is a road network. There is, of course, our infrastructure, and there is some private property in certain communities, but it's largely a natural space. And it is phenomenally popular, being only 15 minutes from Parliament Hill. So very well. Location, location, location. That said, it is very special, not just for its location, not just for the things that we offer, but for what we have. It's actually remarkable that a natural space exists so close to these major urban centers. 80% of the park is covered by forests. We have many, many watercourses, lakes, and particular habitats as well. And that's what's sort of amazing about it. We have this incredible biodiversity, and a lot of it is linked to some of these kinds of habitats that don't exist elsewhere. So the early escarpment is a very hot, dry microclimate. We have species there that exist nowhere else in Quebec and in some places nowhere else in Canada. Pink Lake is also a very unique ecosystem. And as a result of that, we have unique species. We have species at risk. And that comes with some serious environmental responsibilities and obligations. But that's not usually why people come. They come because we offer a huge range of recreational and cultural opportunities throughout the year. Our most recent estimates puts that at just over 600,000 people who come at least 2.6 million times a year. I know people who go every day. But what are they coming for? They're coming for beaches, for hiking, for downhill skiing, cross-country skiing, winter walking, not the Game of Thrones variety, the picnics, cultural. We manage the Mackenzie King Estate. So there's really something for everyone here, and it's become a 365-day-a-year passion for people. And there's a significant economic impact that brings as well. And also our recent figures are that $241 million are contributed annually to the GDP of the region. What is the master plan? Lucy, that's her specialty, and she'll talk to you about it a little more, but it is our primary policy piece for Gatineau Park. The last one was completed in 2005, and it was a significant plan for Gatineau Park, and I'll share with you a little bit how it influenced us. But what it did was it gave us a vision for park management that really for the first time said conservation is a priority for this park. I just shared with you some of the obligations we have and what makes it special, and that's the prime focus, as well as offering all these terrific recreational opportunities in a way that's respectful of our obligations. There were other objectives through the plan as well. One was to make sure it was better integrated from a regional perspective. We put a focus on cultural heritage. It's also a place to communicate some of the national symbols that we have. But overall, we were encouraged to take an ecosystem approach to the management of the park. It was also it was a heavy document in terms of the work that we had to follow. It directed many further plans and studies, and I'm happy to say that when we completed our assessment in June, a lot of those were met. What were some of those plans? Well, there were five major ones. The first one that we completed was the Ecosystem Conservation Plan, which itself directed many activities and particularly a lot of knowledge acquisition, which I'm happy to say we completed and is really giving us an advantage in terms of our management approach. We also completed one for outdoor activities, for sustainable transportation, for cultural resource protection, and also for interpretation. And since then, again, many more studies. We've produced our status report on ecosystems and got a very good handle on the Gatineau Park visitor and economic impact that I presented some of those. So basically, we're in very good shape in terms of the information that we have going forward into this planning process. And not just information and not just plans and studies, we're real doers too, and we're really proud of some of the things that we accomplished since 2005. One of the directions that was confirmed in the last plan was that we wanted to continue to acquire the private property that exists in Gatineau Park, with the really strategic pieces that are helping us with our conservation mandate. And since 2008, we've acquired just over a third of the private properties that were in the park at that time, a third of the territory, with 61 key properties, many of which were our top priorities. We completed a restoration of the facilities and the heritage infrastructure at Mackenzie King Estate. We've improved significantly the recreational offer. Everybody comes up with new things to do, and then we try to accommodate them. So we have now winter biking in the park. We're offering more services for mountain bikers, significantly more snowshoe trails. We've upgraded our infrastructure for day use shelters and also overnight shelters, and put in some ready-to-camp units and some other facilities in the campground. One of the initiatives that's ongoing, but for the last 3 years, we've been putting a major focus on engaging park users in how they can use our trail network system and find the recreational experiences they want while still respecting, as I said, those environmental obligations that we have, and we'll continue to be doing that. We've also restored parts of the early escarpment in partnership with the rock climbing community. And this is a small sample of a long list. The other part that I think is really important to mention is how successful I feel we've been in recent years with partnerships and with public engagement. I mentioned the trail initiative, which I think is a great example of that. But we have worked very hard to enhance our relationships and develop better partnerships with the regional municipalities because, of course, they overlap directly with the park. Many partnerships. We have about 40 scientific permits that we issue a year for top-level science that happens in our parks, partnerships to deliver events, such as the Gatineau Loppet, private partnerships. We deliver a lot of our programming through volunteers at this point with the Friends of Gatineau Park. They deliver our interpretation. We have volunteer patrollers and volunteer stewardship initiatives. One of the really exciting programs we have is introducing new Canadians to the park and to nature, and they come gamely in winter and put on snowshoes and learn how to have fun in the cold, and then we brought them back this summer and taught them how to camp and canoe. We have an ongoing partnership with the Algonquin community to present culture, many school programs, and lots of public involvement in everything we do. So that said, that's where that plan took us to. I think we're proud of it, and we're ready, I think, for the next step in the revision of the master plan, so I'll pass it over.
Alors, je vais continuer la présentation en français. Donc, avant de vous présenter le plan d'action des prochains 18 mois pour renouveler ce plan directeur, je vais vous parler un petit peu de notre cadre de planification, qui est notre, dans le fond, notre feuille de route. Ce que vous voyez à votre gauche sur l'écran, c'est notre cadre de planification. Tout en haut, on voit le plan de la capitale du Canada 2017-2067 que vous avez approuvé il y a déjà 2 ou 3 séances. Et ce plan donne des grandes orientations stratégiques pour le développement ou l'élaboration des prochains outils de planification un peu plus détaillés, des outils sectoriels par secteur géographique, comme le parc de la Gatineau. Donc, dans le plan de la capitale du Canada, il y a 7 grandes orientations stratégiques qui nous sont données pour guider la réalisation du plan du parc. On parle de propriété privée, d'habitation qui devrait être davantage écologiquement durable, de mise en valeur du patrimoine, de restauration des écosystèmes et de la contribution au développement économique, pour n'en nommer que quelques-uns. Et bien sûr, le plan de la capitale nous redit et nous redonne la direction qu'il est absolument essentiel de continuer à travailler avec nos partenaires pour la mise en œuvre de ces orientations, les partenaires et les municipalités, et c'est inévitable, c'est de cette façon-là que nous allons continuer à travailler dans le contexte de ce nouveau plan. Ce que vous voyez sur la prochaine diapo, c'est vraiment le plan d'action. Donc, vous voyez les grandes étapes de travail, les objectifs qui sont visés, ainsi que les échéanciers pour chacune de ces étapes dans un délai de 18 mois pour la réalisation du plan. Donc, on sépare le travail en 4 grandes étapes. Chacune de ces étapes, il y a bien sûr une approche d'engagement du public et des partenaires qui va vous être présentée plus en détail à la prochaine diapo. Donc, si on regarde à notre première étape, cet automne, nous allons compléter le document du bilan qui permet de constater et de mettre sur papier et de bien documenter l'ensemble des réalisations qui ont été accomplies depuis l'entrée en vigueur du plan directeur actuel depuis 2005. Et Christy en a fait part un petit peu. Les réalisations sont nombreuses et je veux souligner que vraiment nos collègues du parc ont de quoi être fiers parce qu'ils accomplissent un travail extraordinaire au quotidien, dans l'opération quotidienne du parc. Donc, nous allons avoir des rencontres cet automne qui vont permettre au public de prendre connaissance du bilan, mais surtout, ce qu'on souhaite, c'est qu'ils nous communiquent leurs idées sur comment ils voient l'avenir du parc. À cette deuxième étape de notre plan d'action, nous allons utiliser ce que nous avons entendu pour développer et élaborer notre vision préliminaire pour les prochains 10 ans. Nous allons aussi présenter, lors d'ateliers de travail, la vision, l'énoncé de vision préliminaire, et aussi parler avec le public des principes et des objectifs stratégiques qu'on devrait mettre en œuvre dans le prochain plan. À la troisième étape, cette étape comprend l'élaboration des outils pour concrétiser un petit peu plus ces grands principes et ces grands objectifs et réfléchir sur des enjeux stratégiques ou des éléments plus particuliers qui nous auront été soulevés par le public. Encore une fois, il y aura des consultations publiques à cette étape-là. Et de façon plus précise, on va travailler sur un nouveau zonage pour le parc et à des objectifs et des politiques plus spécifiques. Et finalement, la dernière étape, c'est l'écriture, non la moindre. Finalement, c'est mettre tout ça ensemble, rédiger le plan, faire une dernière consultation publique, normalement en ligne, pour présenter l'ensemble du plan à l'ensemble de la communauté et revenir au conseil d'administration pour vous faire une recommandation. On espère être au comité, au conseil d'administration au premier trimestre de 2019. Bien sûr, je veux souligner le fait que nous allons présenter à toutes les étapes à notre comité consultatif d'urbanisme, de design et de l'immobilier, ainsi qu'au conseil d'administration aux étapes charnières pour que l'ensemble des comités de la CCN puissent suivre l'avancement du projet et nous donner leurs commentaires au fur et à mesure de l'avancement. Maintenant, Luc va nous présenter de façon plus détaillée en quoi consistera l'engagement du public.
Merci, Lucie. Monsieur le Président, le groupe responsable des affaires publiques et des communications est conscient que le parc de Gatineau occupe une place importante pour des milliers de résidents et de visiteurs. On voyait tout à l'heure 600 000 visiteurs, 2,6 millions de visites. La CCN consultera la population à chacune des quatre étapes que ma collègue Lucie vient tout juste de mentionner et que vous voyez ici à l'écran. De plus, comme nous le faisons habituellement dans le cadre de la révision d'un plan maître, nous travaillons présentement à la mise sur pied d'un comité consultatif public. Ce comité sera composé d'individus issus de différents groupes d'intervenants, la récréation, l'environnement, le patrimoine, les résidents, le monde des affaires, ainsi que les étudiants. Ce comité aura pour objectif principal de favoriser l'échange d'informations et de partager l'expertise entre les membres du comité et l'équipe de gestion du projet. Il servira aussi à tester des idées, à identifier des solutions et à l'établissement de consensus. Des sessions de consultation avec le grand public auront lieu en lien avec chacune des étapes d'élaboration du plan. De plus, nous complémenterons aussi avec des consultations en ligne. Prochaines étapes, les premières rencontres sont donc prévues en octobre avec une première rencontre du comité consultatif et deux consultations format atelier, une à Ottawa le 19 octobre et l'autre à Gatineau le 26 octobre. Une consultation en ligne sera aussi lancée pendant cette période. Ceci termine notre présentation. Merci, M. le Président.
Oui, très bonne présentation. Merci beaucoup, l'équipe. Est-ce qu'on a des questions? Je sais qu'on a Bob, Mike, Kay, Carol.
Thank you very much. Quick question. Who is on the Public Advisory Committee?
So the Public Advisory Committee is being sort of sorted out at this specific point in time. We're looking at a balance between all of the different categories that I've listed out. Individuals that throughout the years have indicated and expressed a tremendous amount of interest and engagement towards the park. Individuals that are very opinionated and have provided feedback on numerous occasions, but that also sort of provide as what we're trying to do is to create a group that covers as wide of a representation as possible.
Just as an observation, you know, it's fine to engage those who are animated and engaged and have provided us input in the past. I think. The emphasis here should be on the people who are actually using the park over the four seasons. You talk about the hundreds of thousands of people who come to the park. I mean, there's a certain culture that exists of those who embrace and celebrate the park. And they don't all come to workshops. You know, they may not be aware of the online survey, although I think the online survey is a useful tool if you can reach out to the cycling groups and the people who camp it, like Philip, and the snowshoe communities, and all of those groups, encourage them to participate. Maybe put up signs in the Gatineau Park to say, you know, fill in this online survey, because it's their, really, they feel some ownership of the park, and they take care of the park and maintain it and keep it clean for us, as well as the work that we do. So to have this public advisory committee really represent the very wide swath of users, to me, would be the priority for that park, rather than, you know, necessarily the loudest and most boisterous voices. Thank you.
Yeah, great feedback. To have that proportional representation of residents and others that live and work there as well in the community. Mike, and then we'll move to Kay.
This is great that the planning process for Gatineau is underway. Gatineau Park is underway. Looking at the detailed activity plan, I note that the draft plan will go to our advisory committee on planning, development, and real estate in May, and then the final plan will go to them in October. Should we be presenting our action plan to ACPADAR, possibly at their meeting in October, so that they understand what's going on and they're not going to get caught blind in May?
Very good observation. We will add that to the agenda.
Thanks, Mike. Thanks, Susie. Kay, and then Carol.
Bob's question was similar to mine, because there are a number of municipalities, and Luke, this goes to you, would the Meech Lake Homeowners Association be represented? So are we going to ensure that the the PAC, the Public Advisory Committee, includes some of those people who have, just because of the very nature of the roles they fill, to represent their councils or whatever on this committee.
So the Public Advisory Committee is just one component of the consultation efforts that we're going to be using for this master plan. There will also be a separate government relations effort where we will sit with municipalities, both at an elected level, but also at an officials level. Okay. In terms of residents, absolutely, the local community or the residents associations are already part of the an ongoing dialogue that the park has with them, and they will we will continue to use that very important channel to validate at every step of the
process. Excellent. Thank you.
Thank you, Luke. Carol.
Leading Boards has erased all my notes, but as my recollection is, in June we made a vote to spend some money on a study of the campground, and it just seems to me like we're going to do a master plan, but we've already are spending money on another plan underneath it. It just, in terms of strategic planning and how you do things, it just seems rather odd that you would not do your master plan and then move to the next, and I know it's a passion of yours, that particular project, but I wonder if you could speak to that.
You know, I think in the background of all our strategic planning, there's always our operations that go forward, that we continue to do what we've done in the past, and we tweak and we improve. The campground is fundamentally a deferred maintenance issue, and it's keeping up on our infrastructure. So the study that we're looking to do in the next year is not to reinvent the wheel. It's to really hone in on what the best approach is for Lac-Philippe. And I think as we go forward in the master plan, we'll have to do a bunch of little projects like that to develop those options that we can then confirm in the master plan. So all of this feeds into where we're going as a big picture and the strategic orientation. So I don't really see that as a conflict per se.
My thought was, if you know, if they decide that maybe camping, as you had proposed, is not what they want to go ahead with, and then that your report comes and says another thing, I guess it just seems to me like there might be some conflict that comes with between what you think is good in that micro issue versus the macro issue of the big plan. So just a comment.
Okay, and just to. I mean, I think when we came to the board, there were two options that the board didn't support. One was not doing camping at all in the park anymore and getting rid of it, and the other was the status quo. So we're sort of trying now to refine between the other two options.
Thank you.
Okay, la dernière parole, ça va être pour Victor, et ensuite on va bouger au prochain item.
Moi, je pense qu'il y a une étape avant même d'entreprendre les consultations qui était une étape de mieux faire valoir qu'on est dans un processus de révision du plan directeur. Et il y a des outils pour ce faire que si vous demandez aux gens de venir dans un laboratoire d'urbanisme ou dans une consultation, j'ai eu certaines déceptions dans ces consultations où il y a souvent les mêmes personnes qui nous reviennent ou qui sont les habitués de nos consultations, mais en contrepartie, si on travaille bien en amont des consultations pour bien faire valoir à un public beaucoup plus large que ces consultations-là vont se faire, peut-être qu'on va attirer d'autres mondes. Peut-être dans nos consultations publiques, peut-être dans des endroits spécifiques, à Gatineau, à Ottawa, mais peut-être aussi sur des moyens de médias sociaux. Et cet été, il y avait, entre autres, un très bon programme avec Radio-Canada qui nous faisait valoir tous les soirs après les nouvelles à 6h30 tout ce qui se passait en Outaouais à partir de... Je sais qu'Alain Entremont a paru à deux reprises avec le parc Lagatineau. Il y a eu des interactions là, avec la ceinture verte, avec les activités de la CCN, avec les Mosaïques Canada, avec les expositions rurales dans notre région. Mais souvent, les familles vont ramasser un petit peu d'informations pendant la semaine et vont planifier ce qu'ils font la fin de semaine comme activité familiale. Puis ça l'a aidé beaucoup, moi, je crois, cet été, les programmes de Radio-Canada, entre autres. et il y aurait lieu d'être en contact, un meilleur contact peut-être avec les médias écrits et télévisés pour bien faire valoir qu'on veut des idées de notre public. Puis, il y a un autre programme là, qui est à Radio-Canada présentement, là, qui s'appelle Par moi environnement, qui pourrait aussi nous être utile.
Très bon point. Merci, merci Victor. So then, we're going to move to our last item on the agenda, which is the federal land use approval, the National Memorial to Canada's mission in Afghanistan, and the site options.
Members of the board. This item is presented for your approval under Section 12 of the National Capital Act. As you know, commemorations are now the responsibility of the Department of Canadian Heritage for the thematic and the implementation of the monuments. At the table with me today, who has joined me, is Shauki Dukduki, who is the Director of Capital Interpretation and Commemoration. He will be able to answer some of your questions pertaining to the theme and to the specific request. For Canadian Heritage, sorry. Also, to signify, we have Michel Bourque from Veterans Affairs Canada in the audience today. We have Francine Lefebvre, Canadian Heritage as well. Guy Larocque from the Museum of War, as well as the architect, Mr. Moriyama, who was the museum architect, has also joined us today, and welcome. On that note, I would like to pass this on to Jason Hutchison, our Senior Landscape Architect, who will bring you through the presentation before we make a recommendation for your decision. Thank you. Jason?
I'd like to say good morning. Thank you. Just a little bit on the project background. On May 8th of 2014, Veterans Affairs Canada announced that a national memorial to Canada's mission in Afghanistan would be constructed in the nation's capital. The project is being managed by the Department of Canadian Heritage on behalf of Veterans Affairs Canada. The memorial is intended to provide a place of pilgrimage and reflection to encourage public appreciation and understanding of the significance of Canada's mission in Afghanistan and to allow public activities such as remembrance events. The memorial is intended to become an important landmark in the capital's core area, and previously the NCC's Board of Directors granted federal land use approval for the memorial site at Richmond Landing Upper Plaza in January of 2015. Following consultation with the veterans communities, Veterans Affairs Canada requested a second review of potential sites for the memorial in 2016. These sites, you can see on your screen, were the Cartier Square Drill Hall, the Lawn of the Canadian Phalanx Monument, the Richmond Landing Upper Plaza, and a site west of the Canadian War Museum. A little further detail on the site west of the Canadian War Museum. On July 14th of 2016, the majority of Veterans Affairs Canada Commemoration Advisory Group endorsed the Richmond Landing Upper Plaza as the preferred site. Following this, on October 5th, 2016, Veterans Affairs Canada and the Department of National Defence hosted a stakeholder summit where the majority of participants selected a preferred site west of the Canadian War Museum. This slide shows the rough area proposed for the monument in the dashed red line, as well as three views of the site from various angles. This slide shows the site analysis for the site west of the Canadian War Museum. The site is national interest landmass. It complies with NCC plans and has a good thematic association. It's also currently on the site inventory of commemoration sites. We looked at site visibility, site character, universal access, impact on other activities on the site, design guidelines, impact on views protection, site contamination, as well as stakeholder support. Consultations with the Canadian War Museum and the Department of Canadian Heritage revealed that the museum has stated that locating the memorial on this site is inconsistent with the use and intent of the land surrounding the museum, and that it would be inconsistent with the role and function of the museum. In order to mitigate the museum's concerns with the site west of the Canadian War Museum, a more constraining set of design guidelines for the memorial would have to be developed in consultation with the museum as well as other stakeholders. These would ensure that the memorial is developed in harmony with the design of the museum and is well integrated into the landscape with an emphasis on landscape or land art as commemoration. The next steps in the project include further consultations by the Department of Canadian Heritage. These additional consultations will include an online survey done by Canadian Heritage for Canadians at large. Questions will focus on design and visitor experience considerations for the memorial, as well as Canadian Heritage, in collaboration with the NCC's Aboriginal Liaison Office, will engage the Algonquins of Kitiganzibi and Pickwagnagon in discussion of the selected site. Furthermore, Canadian Heritage will consult with groups that regularly put on events around the adjacent LeBreton Park site in order to ensure that options can be found for the location of equipment and that the memorial would be protected during events. Finally, there will be roundtable discussions with the federal stakeholders to provide an update on the site selection and to outline the project's next steps. Stakeholders will include the NCC, the Department of National Defence, Global Affairs Canada, the RCMP, and Veterans Affairs Canada. Finally, once a site is approved, we would develop design guidelines through the fall and winter. The design competition itself would be kicked off, and we would bring the draft design guidelines back to our Advisory Committee on Realty Planning and Design for their review and comment. This takes me to the recommendation that the federal land use approval be granted for an optional site for the future National Memorial to Canada's Mission in Afghanistan on the site west of the Canadian War Museum, and that the preparation and signature of the federal land use approval document for the site selection for the future National Memorial to Canada's Mission in Afghanistan be delegated to the Executive Director of Capital Planning.
I'd like to raise a point of order, Mr. Chairman, if I may. It's the language of the recommendation is somewhat confusing because the word optional means not compulsory. So the decision you're asking the board to give today is one that, according to this motion, would not hold sway. It would not be credible. So what's the rationale for putting the word optional in the motion?
I'll answer that. The initial site on Richmond Landing was approved, and the staff recommendation is still that approval should hold. However, the request of the proponent and Department of Canadian Heritage for the additional site has been considered, and that's what's being put forward to the board. As you heard in the presentation, there are some concerns about what can sit so close to such a monumental and such a distinctive expression as the Canadian War Museum. So the urban design guidelines that will be developed for this site will likely have some constraints, some significant constraints, in order that this design can be respected. And as we have Mr. Moriyama here with us, the architect of the War Museum, who as you will recall, and I was very glad that he our recommendation that he sit on the jury of the National Holocaust Monument was taken some years ago, which led to, I think, a very, very good discussion about how the National Holocaust Monument could coexist with the Canadian War Museum. And I think people will agree that the result is very harmonious. This is an even greater challenge because the site is even closer to the museum at its lowest end as it rises up towards the Regeneration Hall. So I think that given that the proponents are very anxious to have this considered today and have a timeline that is ambitious, this development of design guidelines will need to start on the optional site. But I think it would be prudent for the board to keep the original site as an approval in case, as the evolution of discussion and consultation goes on, were ever to reopen the question, then the site would remain there. My understanding is that once all this is done, that there would be a request to rescind the previous approval of the site. But I think there's some due diligence. As you could see from the presentation, there are further consultations in the wind, but our understanding is that the department's very anxious to move this ahead, so that's why we brought it to you today and with this language.
Thank you for the clarification. I want to speak to this motion, but I'll wait to other people speaking to it too.
So, questions or comments? We will start with Bob, Mike, and Carol, and Kay.
Just two questions. I mean, we've had fairly clear indication from the Canadian War Museum and the architect, Mr. Moriyama, of the Canadian War Museum about the incompatibility of this monument on this site. Is there any indication from them that they believe that the guidelines that you would put in place and the mitigating measures would address their concerns? Or is it your sense that the objections that they have are such that the guidelines will not meet their particular tests? That's point one.
Okay.
And point two is, has the site selection been gone to ACBITAR in any way for their review and comment?
Site selection doesn't normally go to ACBITAR. We will go with the design guidelines. So that'll be very important. But I think with respect to consultations, it's been handled by Canadian Heritage. So I think we'd ask Shoki Dakduki, the Director of Commemorations, to respond to that first question that you had.
We were not involved in this condition. So I will refer back to the design, which is really the mandate of the NCC. So is the question about the design guidelines as such, and if they would satisfy the proponents or the stakeholders?
Well, it would be one thing if the Canadian War Museum said that, you know, we believe that there may be some mitigation measures, or we have some ideas and some suggestions, and here's how it might coexist. Or is their objection more absolute, which is on other principle grounds that this site is inappropriate and there are no mitigation measures that would ultimately satisfy their concerns?
The discussion actually with the stakeholders, no one opposed to the monument itself. There are some concerns related to design, as Mark mentioned. It's really the how this can be in harmony with the design of the museum itself. So the discussion didn't go there, and this recommendation actually it's from the NCC staff. So we didn't have this discussion in particular, like the details. If we impose conditions on design itself, would you be satisfied? We didn't ask those questions.
Just as a follow-up on that, you've mentioned that we normally do not go to ACBITAR on site selection. I've been to some ACBITAR meetings where I think we have, even whether it was on victims of communism, where they did talk about different sites for different settings. Am I confused? When have they looked at sites for, whether it's monuments or something else, where approvals are required?
The victims of communism, of course, was a complex file, and there may have been some discussion. But my recollection, Lucy, is that we have not in the past gone to the ACBITAR committee on site selection per se, generally speaking. Is that right? Yeah. Okay.
Okay. Next question was for Mike.
I need a clarification. We had a process. Stakeholders were involved. A recommendation was made. The board approved it. And now the same proponent appears to be coming back and saying, well, we've talked to a different group of people, and they think that this is a better idea. So therefore, we want you to consider this new proposal. I guess the clarification that I need is, with respect to, boy, this is going to sound really bad. Who is really making the decisions or the recommendations that keep on, now this is twice, and I don't know whether this is going to be a third time, that come to us for approval? I don't quite understand why this is even here. So perhaps somebody can clarify that?
Well, I think, Shoki, you'll need to explain the history of the file a little bit from the department's point of view and to answer Mike's question.
Sure. I think Jason did a good job telling the history. So what happened, we came here in January 2015, and we got approval for the site on Richmond Landing. The site, again, when we went out and consult with stakeholders, no one said the other site is not appropriate. I think everyone considered the site is appropriate, but have its limitations. Its limitation with regard to accessibility, to space, to parking. So we came back to the NCC staff and asked, are there other sites that we can propose to the proponent of this project? NCC staff provided four sites, including Richmond Landing, but we went back to Veteran Affairs Canada, who did another consultation, and in general, this site was the preferred site considering its proximity to the War Museum, accessibility, parking, etc. So we are here today to say, okay, that's what we would like as a site. Different stakeholders, they have different positions. All agree with the project as such. We have some concerns related to design, or some stakeholders have some concerns related to the design and its proximity to the museum. And that's where you're coming from the NCC, which is your mandate from an urban design perspective to decide, yes, it's a good idea. My understanding is the site was actually set aside for a monument. So in the NCC inventory, the site was set as a site for a monument, and I think the question is it a better site for this specific memorial?
Just a follow-up, Mr. Chair. The question to me is, how many more stakeholders are going to be consulted, and how many more other sites are going to come to the table? Because one stakeholder group said this one, and another stakeholder group says this is better. And who are these stakeholders? I mean, who's the proponent here? Is it the Department of Veteran Affairs? Do they have a role in making a decision or guiding something? Or are they saying, NCC, we have a problem, you go fix it?
I won't put it as it's a problem. The proponent is Veteran Affairs. We are responsible for national monuments and federal lands in the National Capital Region, so we present the proponent. So the monument, actually, it's not we have a problem. We have a preference for this site, and the NCC staff presented this site as a potential site for this monument. So the proponent came back and said, I like this site. Okay, we'll take it. And actually, that's, again, it's a mandate of the NCC from an urban design perspective to say, yes, we think it's a good idea, or no, we don't want to have this monument on that site.
Carol.
One of my bete noirs is that people vote against something and don't say why. And so I really want to preface my comments by saying Mike and I live next to the two largest Army bases or Armed Forces bases in Canada. So we know from quite a visceral level the cost of a 12-year, the longest ever deployment of forces in Canada. We live with those people. We live with the results, the PTSD. I hate to vote against something that honors that incredible, incredible, incredible choice that was made for these young people. However, I am very convinced by what the museum said and what I read about their concerns. So I just want to, although voting against it, I hope that we don't delay too long the moving forward with this, because I think it sends a powerful message of our respect for what so many people gave up and suffered. It's the first woman to die in combat. I mean, that's a pretty significant thing. So,
Thank you, Carolyn King.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. First of all, I concur with Carol's statement. I mean, this is a worthy project. And because it's a worthy project, it deserves a worthy place. And the place, in my estimation, is not at the far end of the War Museum property. And I want to say why that's the case. But I just want to go back to Mike's comment too, because there was a record of decision from the Commemoration Advisory Group on July 14th, 2016, recommending Richmond Landing. That decision was upheld in October 5th of 2016, although then they wanted to go and discuss it further with Afghanistan veterans and their families. And that, out of that, of course, came some support for the War Museum. I would ask you again, and I know my colleagues have read the backup, I totally concur with the argument put forward by the War Museum that placing a monument at that end, on the west end of the War Museum, would detract from the architectural vision and be inconsistent with the use and the intent of the land. The museum does not compete with the cenotaph with respect to war commemorations. The Afghanistan conflict is listed on the cenotaph. That's where the ceremony takes place on November the 11th. And that's another reason why other war memorials are not placed near the War Museum, because it is not consistent with their mandate. They do not, the War Museum does not focus on one conflict versus another. And as soon as we placed an Afghanistan monument there, that would tilt the argument toward a focus and detract, in my view, from the overall objectives of the War Museum. And I was extremely touched by the comments of Mr. Moriyama there in a document called In Search of a Soul, because he talks about the pastoral landscape and how it is tied to the fundamental architectural concepts of the museum. And he words it, he says, thus, the new Canadian War Museum emerges gently and almost invisibly from the Ottawa River, growing gradually out of the grassy pastoral landscape of Le Breton Flats. As it rises toward the last and the urban city landscape, its grass-covered roof, and I've been up there and we're trying to grow poppies on it, its grass-covered roof to copper to reflect Ottawa's urban vernacular, particularly the traditional copper capped parliamentary precinct. And he goes on to say, the overall feeling is horizontal, more landscaping than building, and in the end, the ordinary is rendered quietly nationalistic and extraordinary. And it is extraordinary. Richmond Landing, we were there yesterday again. It is a historic site, and the upper plaza is an ideal site for the Afghanistan monument because it will be illuminated, as we have seen in the illumination plan, in the Capitol illumination plan. Its proximity to the Royal Navy monument is there. It's in view of the Peace Tower. It's a historic military landing. And it's visible from the Portes Bridge and the pathways. And it's on Confederation Boulevard. It is a perfect place for the Afghanistan monument, not behind, way west of the War Museum, where only the people who drive the Johnny MacDonald Parkway will see it. So I, like Carol, and I hope other board members, will not support this recommendation and ask the original recommendation for Richmond Landing prevail and be and make the argument back to the commemorative groups the rationale. Right now, I can see why some people didn't like Richmond Landing. It's undergoing construction, and it has not been the focus of a lot of activity. But it will be, and it will be an ideal place for the Afghanistan monument. Thank you.
Do we have more questions or comments? Because I know, so I'd like to turn the table. Okay, Mike.
Sorry, Mr. Chair. One question with respect to the War Museum site. Is there a master plan on the site? Is there an approved master plan that we should know about?
The site is on not on the museum site. It's on NCC land adjacent to the museum site. So there is no other master planning design, urban design document than the museums.
So what you're saying to me is that the museum has a boundary to its development site, and anything that any concept that incorporated adjacent lands was more a design concept as opposed to some type of planning restriction or whatever. Okay, thanks.
Okay, turn to Mark.
Okay, we're running out of time. You know, it's a great question, Mike, because a few years ago when it seemed as though monument sites were being picked almost arbitrarily, just wherever there was an open space and suddenly there'd be an idea for a monument, I initiated a plan, which we called the Capital Military Commemoration Plan, and this was done with Dutoit Alsop Hillier, a very respectable firm. It's a document that's kind of ready to come forward. The election sort of changed the complexion of this, and so that document is sitting. But given the discussion today, I'm wondering if what might be prudent, and the department would have to be a bit patient, but is that we bring that document out, which really treated this question of the environs around the War Museum, where should military commemorations go, how should they be logically sequenced, which I don't think we've had a chance to present to the Department of Veterans Affairs, and which hasn't really come to the board because it sort of directions changed midstream. But maybe that's to elevate this back up to the strategic level, to look at it from a master plan point of view, and then bring that forward, but bring it back through the Department of Veterans Affairs, because they have the veterans, and the, you know, commemorations come from below. They come from the people who need them at the bottom, and they have to be respected. But on the other hand, it might be useful for them to see the broader planning perspective that led to some of these recommendations. Keeping in mind that the inventory of commemorative sites was done probably in the early 2000s, something like that, before, it may have even preceded the War Museum, for all I know, these sites. And so consideration maybe should be given, pardon? 2006, so it goes back to 2006. So, you know, what I would, I guess would like to hear from Shauki if this would create a real problem for you, but maybe what we could do is come back with that master plan as a briefing and get further feedback before putting this to a vote.
As you may remember, both Canadian Heritage and Veteran Affairs and DND were part of the consultation of the National Military Commemoration Plan. And my recollection is the site was the museum, actually it figured on that plan as a potential site for a monument. But I accept and I agree to your proposal. Probably maybe we can go back and sit down with VAC and other stakeholders and see if maybe there are other potential sites. And again, I have to repeat, like, those sites were presented to us and to VAC by NCC staff. So I think
this doesn't preclude in any way the current proposal, but it means a sober reconsideration and reflection, and maybe just an opportunity to complete that planning process, which you saw. I think Michel Bourque is here. He was part of that as well, but I'm not sure all the decision makers now today know of that and how the rationale worked. It would also give us an option to perhaps clarify in greater detail what the design guidelines will entail on the the proposed site west of the War Museum, and make sure the proponents understand the limitations that would be put in effect necessarily on that site. But I think that one concept we could have is to bring it to the ACPADAR committee, but I don't think that's the source of our. We need to go to Veterans Affairs and to you, I think, and to the decision makers involved with the broader planning perspective, and then come back at this. But we could commit to do that in a very short turnaround, not necessarily waiting months to do that. We could look more at weeks to do that.
I think Bob has a comment.
I was just going to say, I agree with your proposal entirely. I think that's a very wise course of action, so that we would not vote on this today.
Yeah, we defer the vote.
And that we'd reflect on the conversation we've had and the various issues and the stakeholders and come back at a future point in time with perhaps ACBADAR and with the proponents' further input. So I think it's...
Yeah, so moving a motion to defer, I think we defer to and encourage, in the meantime, that engagement with Veterans Affairs, Heritage, and the Master Plan. And that we'll revisit this the November board meeting.
The motion should be seconded and it should be voted upon.
Okay. So Bob's putting the motion forward, seconded by... Seconded by Mike. All in favor of this motion? Okay. Thank you very much. Anybody opposed to that motion?
I'm sticking with Richmond Landing.
All right. Okay. Great. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for the spirited discussion and points of view. And fulfilling our mandate with the NCC. Je remercie les collègues, les membres des médias, les membres du public pour nous avoir joindre aujourd'hui. Et on espère que vous passez un bel automne et on se revoit au mois de novembre. Merci beaucoup.